of fear, and it absolutely will not stop. Ever. Until you are dead.
Pussy to the left, pussy to the right. Pussy all day, pussy all night. But my favorite is the side pussy.
It's the Jason Ellis Show.
Feel good inside your butt.
Andrew Groose.
I'm not from the water.
Kevin Kraft.
I like fries and cheese.
Scott Benson.
Come out of the shadows, Jason Ellis.
And Will Pendarvis.
Fuck yeah, I'm Will Pendarvis.
Awesome lineup.
Jason Ellis. This is the Jason Ellis Show.
Don't hit back.
I just wanted to say that Doug Benson is not on the show today, but he did say something in the intro, so that kind of counts like he was on the show. But I played that intro because somebody said, hey man, what happened to that great song, Pussy to the Left, Pussy to the Right? And I was like, I know, right? And the reason I haven't played that intro is because Doug Benson is busy being Doug Benson. So, I hope I covered everything and explained everything so that everybody can be happy and that they can move on with their lives. Thank you.
Speaking of show intros, do you know until this morning I had never seen more than like trailer clips of what was the second Michael Keaton Batman? Batman Returns?
Yeah, that was not a good Batman.
No, it wasn't very good, but as a result, I had never seen the scene where Danny DeVito, playing the role he was born to play, as the Penguin says, I am not a human being, I am an animal,
yeah,
cold-blooded, etc., etc. Like, I knew what it was. I kind of guessed what it was,
yeah,
in the intro, but I'd never seen it before.
He does do a really good job of being the Penguin. He is the best Penguin by far.
Who's the competition? Mickey from Rocky.
Oh, wow. Wait, there hasn't been a new Penguin.
Has there? I could easily
guess. Yes, there has.
Somebody who was.
Cool Beans?
Well, there is a guy that plays the Penguin on Gotham, the TV show that's airing right now. And he's actually really good. I like him.
But not in any more of the Batman movies.
No.
Wow, he looks like a Penguin in real life.
As does Danny DeVito.
Right, yeah. But Danny is more of a Penguin than this guy.
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
Yeah, it was good when he ate the guy's face and shit. He's cool. Yeah, he's real scary.
Yeah, I watched that with my kid.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's Batman, you know?
Yeah.
Kids love Batman.
Yeah. It wasn't a real person's face. It was a movie person's face.
He told me, he went out of his way to tell me, this is not scary at all, which means
he's terrified.
He's going to have nightmares.
Yeah. Cobblepot. Cobblepot's a scary guy. Yeah, I'm scared of him.
I mean, imagine what the Penguin would be like in real life.
He ate a man's face. That's where I draw the line. It's where everyone draws the line. When someone chews on your face, you get very scared and you want to leave. You've had enough.
Except Beyonce.
Yeah, but that's... Look, that was a cracked-out love bite. It wasn't a eating of the face.
No.
I think Beyonce would react differently if she had lost some skin.
I tend to agree.
I'm glad Aubrey was on the show yesterday. And he inspired me. And also, Andrew inspired me accidentally by putting an email in there, and I'm not really sure what's going on. So I thought Tony Ferguson was on the show today. So I've been watching. It's weird because I haven't really planned on that. I've just been watching a lot of video, maybe because that fight is fast approaching, and I keep thinking that Khabib has talked such a mean game that I'm almost positive. I mean, he is the only undefeated guy, that he will just remain undefeated and be the undisputed lightweight champion, but Tony Ferguson talks a really mean game too, and And of course, Conor McGregor is the greatest talker there is in MMA. So I'm watching these three over and over again, watching their fights. And I feel like I know a lot more than I would have just by, you know, my casual theory on what I think Conor is good at and so on and so forth with the other two. But after watching them over and over again fighting, the safest bet is to bet on Khabib to win out of all three because of the way he fights. And if you have to look at the statistically how that would work, because it's luck a little bit. I feel like Tony Ferguson can catch Khabib from his back in a submission, but that's not 5 rounds to wait for that mistake from Khabib is sketchy. But that's how he runs the game. The last fight he fought, I watched him fight fucking Kevin Lee this morning, who was covered in staff. He lost rounds, but he was on his back and he caught him and he submitted him, and it's like he wanted to do that. So it's hard to read whether he does it on purpose or he's got a really good sprawl. Takedown defense is very good when he wants it to be, but I don't think anybody can defend Khabib. And then when it comes to Conor, he is light years ahead of both of them when it comes to boxing. He just fucking straight up is. He's got supersonic leg speed power, and it's more athletically advanced than both of them. It doesn't last as long, and it is nowhere near as good in takedown defense and getting back up off the ground. So to me, if Khabib took down Conor, it is fucking over. Like, unless he survives until the bell goes and then he gets to get back up and get in the corner and then he gets a couple more seconds to knock him out before he gets taken down again. That is how that fight's going to go. Tony Ferguson and Khabib don't knock people out. That's not their thing. They just use everything all the time. But I noticed Tony was lifting his chin in that fight against Kevin Lee. And that is the only... That and he kind of likes being on his back. And I don't know if... kind of liking to be on your back against Khabib is a good idea.
A big favorite. Not huge in terms of like the Ronda versus Holly type favorite, but he's a big
no.
favorite.
No, he should not. Yeah, I mean, like I said, it's leaning towards him because of all the things that he has, all the fundamentals. He's never been beaten, but Tony Ferguson is easily the toughest dude Khabib has ever fought in his life. So, you know, and this is a new era. These guys are in the gym doing new stuff every day. So you don't know. Maybe Tony Ferguson is even better. Maybe Khabib is even better. They don't fuck around. These guys are, you know, the other thing I was reading about Khabib, I actually read some stuff too. I mean, sorry, Tony Ferguson, about how he just makes his own shit up. And then watching him fight the way he trains, you can tell he's got really weird shit that barely makes any sense, but it works out for him. He has weird, tricky elbows, and he'll lean. He can take tons of damage too. So it's. I feel like if Tony does win, it's like they scrap on that. They stand up, and then they get taken down, and in the end, Tony's on his back getting beaten, and he catches Khabib in some crazy 10th Planet submission. But I don't see either one of them winning by knockout. You know. I think they're so tough that both of them could get elbowed in the face and be bleeding so much that a ref could stop that. But I don't see those do. But I do see Conor McGregor punching both of them on the chin and them getting put to sleep. Because I've been watching him a lot lately, and I was doubting him more in the last 6 months from everybody else. I'm like, you know what? He is kind of full of shit. But I've been scrutinizing his ass lately, too. He is fucking precise. He is a fucking snake. And he can switch you off.
But will he have the hunger?
See, I don't question that at all. I feel like that dude's just like an MMA junkie. Just give that show a plug. He is all about it. I don't know. I don't hang out with him. I just feel like he's in the gym all day doing these weird things. I feel like Tony Ferguson has such a crazy upper body shoulder thing going on. Like it looks to me like he does some other workout that we're not aware of to make that body shape. Like I feel like he's very skinny in the midsection, but if you look at his underarm, like this part of his, he's fucking gigantic. Like he's got wings He's got like a giant reach too. He's, look, 76 inch reach versus a 70 against Khabib. So
yeah.
And he has these good fall away left hooks and stuff. He's, this is a I'm not doing it for everybody. I was doing it for everybody listening, but I'm also doing it for me to enjoy the fight more. I feel like if you watch, I mean, these are the best. This is the best MMA's ever been, and these are the best dudes in MMA. So I feel like, you know, these two and Conor are the three. It's the biggest. It's the best war that the world has in fighting. There's nothing more exciting. These dudes are never. They're just so weird. Everything they do is so fucking insane. Like, Tony Ferguson has stories about, apparently he runs past his entire camp, like he laps them in Big Bear, just running like a maniac. So that means he can tear you apart and not be tired, and he does the weirdest shit. Like, he's got all these weird little, he stands funny. He's not stock. It'd be very hard to read him, you know?
It's a shame these guys can only fight as often as they can just because of the nature of combat sports.
Right. I mean, we're so close now. Do they... I wonder if Tony and Khabib, are they still flat out right now, or are they starting to wind it down? Because this would be the bit where everybody would be shitting themselves, right? You're wondering whether they're both going to make it in one piece. Right.
Make sure we're healthy. So I would anticipate Tony tomorrow probably has a couple fights, but then he's got to head to New York for all the media.
Couple fights?
A couple training sessions.
Oh.
But then would taper down the last week.
Yeah, I wonder what they're... I mean, I feel like everybody gets a lot more professional these days. People definitely don't get hurt the day before it or anything, but I would love to know when is it... When have both camps said, like, enough of the really intense training? Because that's when you know... Because that's the only thing that I'd be worried about right now is those two showing up in one piece.
You'd also... Some of Khabib's past issues would be, I think, a bigger concern for them. Tony, I don't think, has ever had weight issues, but Khabib, at least, with the tiramisu or whatever he eats.
Yeah, but that's... Come on, man. That was a long time ago. And this is the biggest fight of his career. You know, this is it. This is the one where you have to show up in shape. And when he was here, and also in the Sirius XM bathroom where he didn't wash his hands after he took a shit, he was in shape for... He was on weight then. That was ages ago. So, I don't think... This is the... You know, when you've made it to 25-0 and you've got the biggest fight of your life coming up where you get to... I mean, if he wins this fight, then there's only one fight left, and then there's no fights for him. You realize that? Like, he retires undisputed, undefeated lightweight champion of the world. The greatest lightweight that ever lived. Why would you take a second fight? And I don't think Khabib's the kind of guy that's like, I want super fight. I don't think he gives a fuck about a super fight. I think he just wants what he's going to get. I mean, yeah, but, you know, I mean, I want to see, you know, I mean, samurai guys fight fucking monks. I'm an idiot. But I'm just saying, for him, what's the smart move? Seriously, knock out Connor or beat up Connor and then fucking retire. Like, there is nobody. Oh, what, Kevin Lee? Fuck off.
One of the things he said when he was in here last was, though, he wants fights in Russia, whether it's Moscow or other cities. And so, I don't know if he keeps going, if part of the new deal that he signs with the UFC is...
That would ruin the sport. Moscow, Russia. Yeah, I agree. There's a market, but don't take everything over there. It's like if it was at one point almost half the UFC was the people that had the belts were Brazilian. Don't make UFC Brazilian. You know, we're talking about the greatest fighters in the world, greatest athletes in the world, but we're also talking about entertainment, and there is no question that the greatest entertainers in the world are Americans in America. That's where they do it. So don't take it anywhere else if you want to make MMA big. You can go there, have a fight in Russia, but then come back here quickly. Because they're boring. They're lame.
Well, but if you're saying why would he fight ever again, that would be a reason for him to fight once more.
But what if he got that that fight with Connor in Russia?
Because
I feel like that's kind of... I didn't hear Connor saying that he actually wanted to do that at one point. So that, to me, is what Khabib really wants. He wants to win in his hometown, undisputed, undefeated. And then I'm saying if he beats Connor and he gets it in Moscow, what then what?
Right.
Unless there is some new dude that starts breaking the scene where you're like, oh, he would win for sure. But I mean, as it stands right now, name anybody that comes close to these three.
Right, and I don't get the impression that, of course, everybody wants to be financially compensated properly for, you know, reaching the top of that mountain, but I don't feel like I'd be surprised if Khabib is the guy who's setting up a fight against, you know, Manny Pacquiao.
Right, he has no interest in it.
Yeah.
He doesn't, he's not like a exciting guy to watch, you know, like he's not. You got to be an MMA guy to, you know, he's not a flashy guy. He's not an entertainer. He's the toughest lightweight in the world is what he is. And that's it. That's what he's going to give you. He's not going to give you, I don't even think he does like spinny shit. I'm going to get my hands on you and I'm going to fucking fold you up and beat your ass like a bitch.
And that's good on the show. I thought he was like not super charismatic like Connor, but I thought he was.
I didn't say, yeah, I'm not saying he's the, I'm just. What you're trying to lean a?
I think he was dull.
Really?
I didn't think so.
What about compared to somebody? You're saying dull? Okay, he wasn't dull compared to what? Because I would say entertainment-wise, he's dull. In MMA, he's not as dull as the DJ from Linkin Park. Like, what the fuck are we ranking here? He wasn't that exciting, dude.
But
or was he?
Like, you've had Max Holloway on the show.
Yeah. Time. Okay. What do you think they're about even? Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. I don't think fighters are really known for being super charismatic. That's this other thing where, you know, even Tony. Tony's very amusing. He's nowhere near as charismatic as Conor. No one is, but Tony's a really weird, amusing guy that speaks English. So he's such a weird threat, and he's his own thing. And look, so is Khabib. I'm just saying, don't.
Wonderboy.
Yeah, okay.
Robbie Lawler, I would put Khabib in front of.
I disagree. I thought Robbie was. Get to see who they really are. Robbie's Robbie. That's what I found out.
Yeah, well,
there's no other side of him.
Also, are you talking about like interesting or like marketable? Because I think Khabib is sort of interesting because he's a different sort of guy than we've seen. I would be really interested in having lunch with him and having him tell me the real shit about his life and what makes him tick and stuff like that. But if you're talking about like, I'm fill in the blank and when I'm not fighting, I drink Bud Light. That's Robbie Lawler all day. Compared to Khabib.
Yeah.
He
is? Oh, I mean, I would hope so.
The hat's a thing. He's got the hat. The hat's really the hat's the marketable one.
Yeah, don't take the hat off. And I don't know. I just don't think you want to keep it here. That's all.
Speaking of, you mentioned supersonic leg strength. I saw where Joe Rogan went to the the UFC training facility and hit the pad that Ngannou set the punch record on.
Mm-hmm.
Joe got the same number, but with a kick.
So he's the hardest kicker in the world?
I don't think that makes him the hardest kicker in the world, because I think the idea... He himself was just like, man, that just goes to show you how strong Ngannou is, because my legs, for example, I walk on full-time, so of course they're stronger. No. Nobody's saying that makes him... I just think it's impressive.
You know he's not at the UFC gym. You know he's at his radio show where he now has a punching and kicking pad.
Well, then it's the exact same one. The story that I read said...
Good idea, right, Andrew?
Yep.
The story that I read said that he was most definitely at the UFC facility.
He has everything I ever wanted.
His studio is just unbelievable.
I'm sorry, but I'm completely jealous. Completely. He is. I pitched that 10 years ago. I was like, Will, we've got to have it. I saw it at a convention. Like, fucking. I just want to go there and kick it.
One of R. Kelly's exes said, in addition to a bunch of other predictably slimy things, that he trained a 14-year-old girl to be his sex pet.
Who's a sex pet?
R. Kelly allegedly had a 14-year-old sex pet.
Why is it always alleged? Like, how come you... How
know,
do you
why
not...
can't they go knock on his door? I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, I think when the story came out about the girls who were supposedly slaves,
yeah.
they were adults, and I think maybe somebody did go knocking on the door, but they were like, I don't know, my mom's crazy, I'm fine. So what can you really do beyond that?
God, it's so terrifying to know that a parent can lose their kid that much.
So there, the woman is not the former sex pet. The woman who's talking about the alleged former sex pet is a 34-year-old woman now who said that she dated R. Kelly beginning when she was 27 and he was 44. All this in a BBC documentary, R. Kelly, Sex, Girls, and Videotapes. She claims that R. Kelly was grooming her to be one of his sex pets, took her to his sex dungeon where he forced himself on her. She claimed Kelly forced her to have sex with him and others, and she claimed she met a girl that R. Kelly allegedly bragged he had groomed since she was 14 years old. It's all very incredibly disgusting.
Hmm.
I saw that she was dressed like me and that she was saying things I'd say and her mannerisms like were like mine. That's when it clicked in my head that he had been grooming me to become one of his pets. That's what he called them, his pets.
I mean... Nobody's listening. You gotta kill that guy, right? I mean, people gotta kill him.
And R. Kelly's... I didn't even know that this was controversial in the slightest, but...
It's all a big conspiracy and he hasn't done anything.
R. Kelly's former manager, Rocky Bivens, in this BBC documentary, claimed he was at the wedding between R. Kelly and Aaliyah, who was 15 years old at the time. R. Kelly has always denied that that marriage took place. And again, he really does exist seemingly outside of the boundaries of the law. Because I thought there was, like, a marriage license and everything.
I don't know. So, wait. How old is he now?
He is, I think, 51.
He looks great.
Yeah, he does. He does.
I guess you gotta look young when you're trying to bang 15-year-olds. I just don't understand how all this stuff in the world, people getting destroyed for little things. And this guy is just raping children. Allegedly.
Well, what it has to come down to, and I've said this
before, how many alleged rapes has he done now? Like, fuck, dude. You know, it's like, is the government after him? Because if the government was after him, he'd already be locked up. So they're not doing it, and they're not after him. It's just, he fucking is doing stuff like this.
Well, and then also, like with the Aziz stuff, the allegation is one thing, and then the way that people who pay money to see you do your thing receive it is the second part. And I don't know what's going to happen with Aziz because he wasn't really accused of a crime or anything, but I'm sure some of his fans are turned off. It seems like R. Kelly is still touring. So this stuff is out there, and either it's not reaching the people who buy tickets to R. Kelly or the people who it reaches do not care.
That's pretty crazy that you don't care. I feel like if my daughter was like, I'm going to an R. Kelly concert, I would be like, you're going to rehab. Because yeah, that'd be like, I'm going to smoke crack, daddy. You may as well say that to me. Because that's... What's wrong with you? What's wrong, world? What's wrong, mom and dad? You got your kid going to R. Kelly concert? Or is everybody going to the R. Kelly concert 25 and up? Because after you're 25, you can't really tell your kid not to go.
No, it's your decision to be an R. Kelly fan once you're...
25, right?
Yeah, once you're an adult.
But if you're 21, I would be... I don't know if I... I mean, I know I can't stop her, but I don't know, man. I feel like I could hire security to hold her down until the concert ends. Like, you can't go. You cannot go. It's like you're supporting rape, in my opinion.
Yeah. What would you rather, that she's going to an R. Kelly show or that she goes, hey, man, I'm just, I just want to go check out a Klan meeting. No interest in joining, just want to see what that's all about.
Oof. I mean, is her boyfriend taking her? Because if her boyfriend's taking her, no, you cannot go. It's just you? Like, are you filming it for a documentary or something? Yeah. Rather that than the R. Kelly concert. You could do a show on what's worse than your daughter saying she's going to R. Kelly. What's worse? There's nothing worse. I mean, the dude's alive and he's on... He has followers. Did you show me that fucking Is Mariah Carey hanging out with him?
Well, I saw that he sent her a birthday greeting yesterday via Twitter, and there's a photo of them. You can see that they're recording some vocal together.
Yeah.
I don't know when they recorded something together.
So there you go. Mariah Carey backs rapists, in my opinion.
Worse if your daughter's like, yeah, I've decided to start a romance, a pen pal romance with Jared from Subway. That's worse.
No, it's not.
I'm dating Chris Brown.
Yeah, actually having a one-to-one contact with the person has to be worse than just going to watch him perform Step in the Name of Love.
Wait, if you send a note to the dude from Subway, that's worse? I mean, it's just a letter to the guy in Subway. You didn't say you want to marry him, right? You just like, hey, what's your deal in Subway?
You said a love note.
Oh. Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah, I'd rather they went to R. Kelly. Yeah, yeah. Okay, you win. Nice one, Andrew. Nice one. That is for sure words. But apart from that, I mean, come on, everybody. I know there's not that many people listening, but what's wrong with you, the world? I mean, little things like that one. You know, the gun control, we can't solve that, but surely we could get a gun and kill him. I mean, what the fuck are you doing? Fuck you, dude. Piece of shit. In my opinion. If I say my opinion, I mean, who cares?
I can call him a piece of
give
shit.
Give him a fucking channel. See if I care. Piece of shit he is. Hey, fuck that guy.
In other news,
yeah.
Corey Feldman was stabbed.
Aww!
Says...
Corey Feldman. Oh, okay, so. God, so, he's such a wanker. How's he going?
He told police. So there's a photo of him in a hospital bed. Is there a photo of the alleged wound? Nah, right? I think they're having a little trouble finding it. Corey told police he believed he was being followed. At some point, his bodyguard, who was a passenger in his car, shined a flashlight towards this other car. And I think the idea is that three guys came up to distract his bodyguard.
Yeah.
And then another guy who was in the passenger seat, another guy came up to the driver's side. Corey said he stabbed him with some sort of syringe or other sharp object and then took off.
Oh, gave him AIDS.
And the cops now say, I'm sorry, I misread this, now say there is some sort of mark on Corey's abdomen. Cops believe it was a road rage incident. But he said that, he said that there is a wolf pack out to get him.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Like, they're called the wolf pack?
He's been getting online threats from some group of people that he refers to as the quote-unquote wolf pack.
Why are you going to make him look cool?
I have to believe it's all connected, Corey says. Enough is enough.
So he got stabbed with an AIDS needle because he kept talking about people... molesting children in Hollywood.
That's right.
You should have kept your mouth shut. We warned you. Now you're spracking off. AIDS needle! Hollywood! Hollywood in the house!
Like, what would you even...
Hollywood, mean? Stand up! Sorry.
You can't silence him with AIDS.
Yes, you can. I mean...
In a matter of months or years.
Oh, yeah.
Assuming he doesn't treat it.
Oh, he will treat it. He's not going to treat it. I forgot about that. Okay, it's a needle that has Ebola in it.
It could have.
What is it? Ebola. Yeah, Ebola, sorry.
I think he said that they're running tests to make sure that it's not a poison or a virus.
It's probably a virus or a poison for sure. I always have a poison needle in my car for road rage too. You cut me off, you get AIDS. Yeah. Remember the next time you come up alongside a guy with a wolf head tattoo. It's not worth it.
Playboy is...
He's still got girls with him.
I know.
He allowed a weed pen in hospital? That's pretty crazy. Good for him. Huh? Celebrity.
Well, they don't search you on the way in, right?
Yeah, but he's got it in his hand in the hospital bed.
Mm-hmm. But think about it. It wouldn't have to be allowed. If you went to the hospital and you had that with you, or, you know, your angel... had it with you or something, and then they come in and check on you, and they're like, right, you're the guy that there's nothing wrong with because you made up some crazy story for TMZ. We'll check back in an hour or so. Well, then she hands you the pen, and you're off for the races.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I wouldn't imagine, I would tend to think that even if he had legitimately been stabbed and told I would tend to think that there are some physicians in the present day who have you said, look, man, I smoke weed. I think it helps with pain relief. They'd be like, yeah, dude, have at it.
Can...
You have AIDS. I mean,
well... Yeah, no. Somebody just gave you AIDS. Smoke the pen. Can we get him on the show to see how bad his stabbing is? He's never going to come back on here, huh? Jude ruined it. I know, right? He might not remember these studios. What about if we... No, I have him at my house. Just have him at my house so he doesn't know it's Sirius XM.
He was friendly with you.
Yep, I know. I want to talk to him. I feel sorry for him. I find him very interesting.
I do, too. I think it's sort of a fine line that I really would love to follow that story and remain in touch with him. And it's not because I believe him. It's also not because I think he's completely full of shit and I want to make fun of him. It's because I think that there is some gray area to what he's talking about, and I find it a little mysterious and a little interesting, and I'm just simply interested in hearing his account of what he says is going on with him. I'm not really in a position to judge it. Do I think a lot of it is bullshit? Yeah, that's my suspicion, but like I say, not a setup. Not just a let's laugh at the crazy guy.
I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why I feel like we're old enough to read between lines here, so I'll ask some questions and get some info on what it's like, because I think it's hard.
Yeah. Playboy is quitting Facebook for... It's so stupid.
Nobody cares about it.
No.
Playboy?
I think Playboy kind of did the math, and I think they said they had like 25 million followers on Facebook, which might be... I don't know, might be true. But it doesn't take much to follow something. They said because Facebook is sexually repressive, which is not something that they got into explaining in any detail. This is, I think, Cooper Hefner, the son, who said this. But also because apparently Playboy as an organization are outraged at the data breach.
Yes, I am too.
So
that's why I left.
We believe in two things, hard nipples and safe data.
Yeah. Yeah. And if I don't have both
of
those.
That's why Daddy made this.
We're fighting. Daddy made this. Yeah.
Oh man, I'm struggling. I've had like an eye headache since last night.
What the fuck is an eye headache?
Like eye strain. I used to get it a lot when I was a kid. It's a headache, but it's just like in
your eye hurts.
Yeah.
Fuck. Like burning or aching.
Ache. Oh! A sharp ache, like a pin. It's like a pinpoint headache.
Oh!
I had it in both my eyes this morning when I woke up, and
both.
I think I've just been looking at screens too much, really. But
does it hurt when your eyes are open, or feel better if it's closed, or what?
Doesn't make a whole lot of difference.
Fucking hell, migraine people are.
I'm not usually one of those people. Headaches for me very quickly go to nausea.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, right.
Same with Katie. She's got the same thing going.
Exactly. I could...
She's on steroids.
I could very easily vomit right now. I'm not sick. It's just... It feels... I think your body...
That's weird.
Your
she
body
has
gets,
it too.
Your body gets the idea that if you were to vomit, that might relieve some of the pressure on your eyeball or something. So, yeah. If I seem to be pacing myself, that's the reason why.
Wow.
What else is going on? Credible UFO reports in Arizona.
Show me the video.
Don't know that there's video.
That's not true.
But there is some fairly compelling audio. Like, if you...
What? I am an alien!
No.
Well, then what?
Well, like, when a guy who just seems like a regular, ordinary, not insane pilot is talking to the, you know, ground control, and he's like, okay, what the fuck just flew over us? And his co-pilot's like, yeah, dude, that's fucking weird. And they're like, what, is it like a UFO? He's like, yeah, I know, dude, right? Like, what the fuck is it? And they go, well, there's this other plane 15 miles over. And they go... Ask them if they see anything weird. And then a minute later, those guys are like, whoa, what the fuck was that?
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Got that audio?
That audio does exist, does it not?
Andrew's in the zone.
Sorry, I'm jumping around a lot.
Andrew's going off right now. We got Andrew working overtime. Pretty mellow.
Juicy.
Calm.
Is this what pilots do up there? They just sit there saying numbers to people and they say numbers back?
Deadpan. When does the holy shit happen? Because it's going to really stand out. Damn, they're... feel like I'm hearing an interview of Jose Aldo. What the fuck? I can't understand anything.
Hold on, I might have.
Holy shit, look at that! What is that? What is that bit?
Right.
What the fuck? Did you say that?
Okay, here, try me.
Try you. So it was a balloon.
Well, but shouldn't the FAA know if there's a balloon flying 3,000 feet over Learjets?
The balloons don't go up on the radar, though.
But shouldn't they just know if there's going to be something in their flight path? Isn't that the whole point of them sitting there saying numbers at each other all day?
Well, I don't think there has to be something of some sort of, weight. And a plane would just go through that anyway, so it doesn't show up on the map, maybe.
Maybe.
I'm just trying to riff.
Sure. Or maybe it's some...
Man, they sound super official. No one's allowed to laugh on that fucking radio, are they?
No, like, those you can't be sound like they're fucking around.
Two girls walked into a bar. You can't do that at all. Shit, Andrew. Sorry.
Man, you got a lot of beverages.
I'm fucking thirsty, man.
You have four lemonades.
Well, they're not. They're all weird ones. I don't know what they are. So I need, that's one lemonade, and then these are like some other...
That's Yukonuba.
Yeah, that's Yukonuba, and that's Akinabi, and that's Eboli. Yeah, I'm just going to keep drinking it.
So, yeah, the easy thing to say is that, well, the military was doing something and didn't let them know, but I don't know.
I just think it's great to know that when aliens do show up, that we're still going to be super calm,
cool, and collected,
and just be like, aliens are here. over 3256, hike.
Humankind, we had a good run.
These guys are here. They got some great ships. This guy's doing some great turns. It's definitely not one of ours.
They are flaying my co-pilot with their eyeballs.
These guys mean business.
I'm being probed right now, so it's only a matter of time before I die. So, yeah, we're going down.
Save yourself. Kill yourself. Yeah. You don't want to see this.
You just ate my leg. I'm in excruciating pain. Over. It is so relaxed, right? Like, man, poker against those guys. Very tough.
What many parents have suspected, including myself for years, is
kids are terrible.
They're pretty awful.
Yep.
They do have their moments. Taught my dude to tie shoelaces last night.
Oh, did he celebrate? I remember that. That wasn't that long ago for me.
Yeah, he was really pumped about it.
Those are, yeah. Because I remember him like, oh, I can't do it. I'm like, don't give up, dude. You'll figure it out. And then, you know, like a week later, there it is. I'm like, see?
Yeah.
You got it.
It's tricky. You don't even think about it, but the bit where you pull the second loop through the first loop, you got to use your right hand to do two or three things at the same time. It's tricky for them, especially when you don't know what the fuck you're trying to do. You don't have muscle memory.
Yeah, they got stupid kid fingers. They can't do nothing.
Yeah, exactly. It's funny. There's certain things like first steps and first words are big for obvious reasons, but then I put this in the category as like riding a bike.
Mm.
That it just has this power. There's lots of things. That's one of the most rewarding things about having children is watching a human being do anything for the first time over and over and over again. But something about tying shoelaces, even though you know why a lot of kids can't tie shoelaces anymore, is because they don't make shoes for kids
to
have laces.
I know.
Yeah.
Here, have one of my. I just tasted that. It's fucking amazing.
What is it?
It's just
juice. Is it citrusy at all?
Yeah.
I can't have it.
Okay.
Yeah. Particularly if I'm already a little bit nauseous.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much. I appreciate it. But
what about lemonade? That's citrusy, isn't it?
Oh, my God.
Okay, yeah.
That, to me, is like drinking battery acid. Yeah. I've thrown up from drinking screwdrivers because of the orange juice, not the vodka.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So you can't have orange juice in the morning? What about grapefruits? You go.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
That'll kill you.
Yeah. Every now and again, I feel like I've gotten better over the years. I've taken so much better care of myself. Every now and again, I will, like my kid will get some fresh squeezed orange juice somewhere, and I'll take a swig.
And you feel that instantly from the swig, or are you all right?
No, I'm okay with it. Actually does. I might get a couple, like, you can feel that there's a little, the burp.
Yeah.
Is like...
Man, that's weird.
If this burp was multiplied by 30, that would be pain.
Man, that'd be tough for me. I'd have to... I feel like... that's probably one of my most enjoyable things in my life, is citrusy drinks and fruit.
Hey, go ahead and rub it in. Yeah.
Fuck you. I've cut way before you ate blocks of cheese. I'm for the surf hero.
I'm joking. No, I don't really... I like oranges, but not in a way that I really miss them or anything like that.
Yeah, I feel like that's my... especially when you don't drink and you're a fucking Boozy the Clown. You've got to put weird things in your drink to make you feel like you've got something exciting happening.
Right. I always think of that scene in Forgetting Sarah Marshall where they're having the stressful dinner and Russell Brand just keeps on ordering more and more insane non-alcoholic cocktails.
Not
because he's a recovering alcoholic, and the his chick is having an argument with her ex-boyfriend that they're now having dinner with on some tropical vacation, and he's just like, oh, get me the fuck out of here. So he just keeps on ordering more drinks, but because he's an alcoholic, he's just getting these like insane non-alcoholic things with all this fruit hanging.
Right. Yeah, no, that's how I did in Hawaii with the kids. I think I put on 10 pounds on virgin pina coladas. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh yeah, put more of the, because they're like, oh, poor guy doesn't want to have any booze in it, we'll put a fruit salad in the top of it. I'm like, do that.
Yeah.
Work it, baby. Give me more umbrellas. Makes it look like I'm doing something.
Maraschinos.
Yeah, the cherry things. Okay. Yeah, I fucking need more. Fuck it.
So this study reveals what many parents have long suspected: the insides of bath toys, rubber duckies, etc. are fucking filthy.
Yes.
And it's so gross, because what you do is the kid plays with it the first time, it's obviously fine, but then you take it out, and as any parent knows,
there's water in it.
Yeah, no matter how much you shake it, there's always water in there. Well, then that becomes a disgusting incubator that when the kid takes a bath again a couple days later,
sucks the water up and squirts it back out, often into his mouth.
Yeah.
And shit like that.
Yeah. Yeah, here's a pretty groovy cross-section of what the inside of a rubber ducky might look like. It's got that gnarly brown, black, dirty shit. Yeah,
makes sense.
Yep. And
funny how we just don't think of things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah, the bath toy, the inside is like a weird, nobody dries it out, and it makes stuff, gross stuff in there, and squirt it out on yourself.
And it's just another good example of where people are selectively, oh shit, sorry about that, selectively, you know, like, I know kids who have to use hand sanitizer literally every single time they go in the house from outside. That's just like a rule. There's a hand sanitizer by the door, and when you go inside, put some hand sanitizer on. I don't know if that's good or bad. I can see the angle. But that very same kid might well be playing with a dozen filthy rubber duckies at all times, and since the parents can't see it and they didn't read about it on Facebook one time, they don't do anything about it, and guess what? Kid's just fine.
Did Facebook crash yet? Is everybody over it?
I still don't think my mom is quitting.
Yeah. Well, I called my mom. My mom's on there.
I don't think anybody's mom is quitting. I saw Elon Musk deleted his pages.
Who's that again?
The Tesla founder guy.
Yeah. He's a great guy, isn't he?
And Zuckerberg is going to testify in front of Congress, and they're just going to tee off on that guy. Because it's just an easy way to score political points with your constituents and to showboat a little bit on national TV, you know, all channels at the same time. So they're going to kill him over how could you... He promised years and years ago that your data was safe with Facebook, and he clearly has been, as if he wasn't making enough tens of billions of dollars harvesting people's data in legal ways, i.e., hey, this guy's always talking about Khabib, let's throw a UFC ad up on his page, which, you know, that's fair. He's gone even further than that and sold user data to, you know, pretty fairly obviously slimy. This, I don't know what they had to do with Trump. That's not what I'm talking about. But this campaign consulting firm that he sold 50 million people's data to, they seem like the kind of people, you know, when you see in a movie, like a Jason Statham movie, like some guy's running for president of like some shitty African country and they're fully like poisoning people.
Yeah.
They seem like people who do that. Yeah.
Wait, what?
Financial straits and borrowing a ton of money, so they might.
What?
There is a concern that they will go under in the next year.
Really?
Yeah.
So the only people.
They made these big promises that we're going to turn out 5,000 models or 5,000 cars a week.
Yeah.
The new model, and they just haven't hit that. So now he's borrowing billions of dollars, and there was a report that they could go under in the next year.
If you look into it,
I think people say stuff like that. Because they hate him, but people like that don't go under, dude.
Well, like Tesla wouldn't go under. Somebody would take it over.
Did Howard Hughes go under?
I don't know how it ended up for Howard Hughes. I can't imagine he was running his companies as well as he might have at the crazy end.
Because I remember there were always threats of him going under all the time because of all the money he was putting into his airplanes.
I don't know what happened with Howard. I still haven't gotten around to the Aviator. But I do know that Elon Musk, one of the very few things that I know about him is that he has built the company through a series of really audacious bets. Like, he started off with, like, okay, I got $100 million, and I'm betting it all on something that kind of looks like a long shot, and if that comes through, then I'll have $1 billion.
Okay.
And then I will bet that on this thing that's kind of a long shot, and then I'll have $7 billion.
And it's worked out for
so far, so good. But he has been living on the... Now, this may well be a totally different thing. This may be a much worse problem. It may just be simply that one of his long bets finally isn't coming in, as mathematically one is bound to sooner or later. But that has sort of been his risky model the whole time, I believe.
It seems like people, I mean, I guess I live in a fucking alternate universe, but I see those stupid cars everywhere. Everybody loves them. But then again, since I moved to Hollywood, I think I see the same guy in a Bentley with 24-inch rims, but it's not. There's like six of them in this fucking, in like a 4-mile radius. This town is weird. So Teslas are everywhere. Everybody has them. But...
Yeah.
Isn't there a cheaper one coming out?
Well, that's the problem. The expensive ones they're making, but the Model 3, which is the, I think, like, starts at 35.
Oh, they have it, and nobody's buying it.
No, they haven't been making them. So they were promising to make 5,000 a week by the end of last year, but only made 222 in a 3-month span. So
oh.
There are people that want to
Yeah, that's an issue.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's quite a bit less than 5,000.
Yep. It's real bad news there for them.
But if they could get them out there, like, I think that kids would be, like, your kid, my kid. I think many people, I don't think this is just a Los Angeles thing. I think if you're a young person who's able to, you know, potentially lease or own a car in the under $25,000 range and you look at the things that are available to you, I think to young people today, Tesla's, like, super cool.
Yeah.
You'd rather have that than like a Ford.
Yeah.
If it's available.
Yeah, and if you can get the cheaper one, so yeah. it's like an Acura, but it's a Tesla.
Yeah.
It's fucking cool.
Yeah, that's cooler.
And they drive cool, they're all convenient and they park easy and probably got all those little beepy things so you can just back around and cameras and all that shit. Congratulations to everybody in there. I was contemplating getting an electric bike.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I just, you know, I'm not old enough yet. I don't know if I can be trusted. I feel like I'm just going to have to, like, every now and then thread the needle.
Why would you not be trusted with one of those?
Because because every now and then I'll have to thread the needle.
Ah.
And you can't, you know what I mean? Like, every now and then you thread the needle, and then Mum does her fucking lipstick and changes lanes.
Oh, yeah.
And you're fucked.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so.
Hey, you're a dead man rolling.
Right, but these ones that I saw on the street, which is the street that I go up to my house from here, and it looks like it had like a bike rack on the front. It looks like a fucking bicycle. And I'm like, could I just cruise on the sidewalk? Because people, LA, ladies and gentlemen, where I live to where I work is not far, but I feel like I could just cruise down. I would get there faster than a car because of all the lights and shit.
That was generally my experience. When I used to drive from my old house to Swing House, which was a straight shot Hauser, I would pass a bike, and then the bike would catch up to me. And I would pass a bike, and the bike would catch up to me. And generally, if I'm driving straight up this road for about 15 minutes, however far that is, a couple miles by LA standards with a lot of stop signs and traffic lights, yeah, it took me about the same amount of time. And I would definitely ride on the sidewalk. And you give me all the fucking tickets you want. I'm not riding on the road.
Wait.
On these side streets?
Wait, you get a ticket for being on the sidewalk, on a bicycle?
I don't think you're supposed to ride on the sidewalk because they've been building all these bike lanes.
You don't get a ticket for that, do you, Kevin?
Not in L.A.
I was going to say.
I've set up because it's incredibly annoying. I've had people, like, damn near nick me.
Yep.
But I'm pretty sure it's legal in L.A.
Better you than me. Good. I'd rather a pedestrian get nicked by a bike than a bike get nicked by a car.
I agree again.
All day, every day. Although you got to be careful of cars backing out. Our esteemed former mayor got hit by a car that was backing out of a driveway, and he was on a bike.
Slammed the hood of my car, turned into this building this morning. She was on an electric scooter, and she just kind of zoomed up, and I let the person walking in the sidewalk pass through. I didn't see her lying down the sidewalk, so I turned in. She had to like put the brakes on her scooter, on her like Razor scooter, the electric one, really quick, and slammed the hood of my car. Sorry, lying on the sidewalk, I didn't see it.
So you murdered a lady this morning?
Almost. Did you tell her to fuck off? I should have. I
just drove away. You hit me.
Yeah, I went straight to the parking lot.
I got one. I turned around to go in the parking lot today, and you have to go around the back now because they, I don't know, something. But as I was going to turn across a busy street, a very busy street, there was a dude with headphones on a fucking motorized skateboard in the left-hand turn thing in front of two cars, and he looked back at both of us and was like, oh, you know, hi guys, and I'm like, you are not gonna fucking wait for cars to leave and then get on that skateboard and pull out. And sure enough, this fucking tool did that at about 2 miles an hour, and I'm like, oh my god, dude, like, pick it up and run across, you fucking knob. Like, he became a car. He took the car lane.
Oh, hello, happy motoring.
Yeah, and then, like, cruised off, and I'm like, and you've got headphones on, so you can't even hear people. Fuck, I hope you die. I just realized I could have run him over in a side street. No one would know. Fuck.
R. Kelly. Next time. Motorized skateboarder. So many people to kill. So little time.
Yeah. Oh, you know. Wait till I get fired.
Powerball, $500 million.
$500 million. See, what do you get? $200
million? I don't know what you actually get. Yeah, sure. Fine. Yeah.
$250. Or, wait, when it gets this big, doesn't it turn out that, like, 8 people win or some shit?
Obviously, the bigger it gets, the more people are going to play. The more people who play, the more likely it is that more people are going to hit the same number.
Mm-hmm.
But it has surpassed the $500 million mark for only the 4th time in history.
43 people on YouTube right now. We're fucking huge.
That's big.
Right?
That's almost one per state. Not counting Canada.
I like that. I'm going to Canada soon.
Yeah, I think I am too.
We are, huh?
Yeah, I hope so.
I'm going to like tattoo. I'm going to a tattoo expo as well.
Oh, are you?
I think. I'm doing a lot of stuff.
Yeah, you sound busy.
I know. I think I'm getting on a plane a lot soon.
I like flying.
I'm weird about it. I'm getting those masks. SARS mask.
I don't blame you.
Dude, you just like, when I go on vacation, I get in the plane, mm-hmm. and a dude sits next to me and goes, achoo!
Yeah.
After listening to this show, I'll be like, oh! He's gonna get me sick for vacation. Like, you, what do you do now? Now that you, like, if your guy's next to you and he's got a cold, what do? You can't get out. Can't ask the lady to sit somewhere else. You're gonna make someone else sit there and get sick.
Yeah, and you can't tell him to stop being sick. Yeah. It's over.
Wow. I wonder if there's like a, if you have the SARS mask on and he's there, then you are in the clear, right?
I wonder what the numbers are on that. It's gotta help significantly, but nothing's 100%.
But man, that is a definite thing to get ready for. Like, you have that on you when you get on a plane in case somebody does that. I mean, it's not rude. I would seriously say, hey, I just found out the other day that there's this thing in the plane that the person who's sick, if you're within 2 seats of him, you guarantee to get it.
Yeah.
So I've, no offense, but I'm putting my SARS mask on because I can't leave the seat. But I'm just telling you that so you don't feel like you're, that I'm being rude.
I would just tell the person next to me, just so you know, I'm putting this on not because I am sick, but because I feel like there's a lot of shit going around this winter and I don't want to get anything from anybody else. I would just let the person next to me know that, because you see that and you assume that you're sitting next to Corey Feldman, freshly infected with the AIDS by the Wolfpack.
Oh, see, I would think that I put it on and now I'm offending the person next to me that sneezed. Because I'm like, oh, you're disgusting, I'm putting a SARS mask on.
Yeah, I don't think you can worry about offending that guy.
I know. But if I sneezed and if somebody pulled a SARS mask out next to me, I'd be like, really? But not now, not after what you told me.
It's so tricky, but I really wonder how many people really cancel flights, cancel travel, be it for work or family or pleasure. If you're really, really sick and you're like, I don't even feel like going on vacation or whatever anymore, or I can't go to this work thing, yeah. But how many people go, yeah, I could go, and I'll probably be okay in a couple days. I just don't want to get strangers sick on the plane.
75 people are watching us now.
Wow.
This is the biggest audience I've ever had on YouTube.
We can build on this.
I just want to say hello to my mother and, you know what I mean, everybody. Mm-hmm. And we, you know what I mean, thanks for the support.
Probably want to read an ad.
Oh, yeah.
Lemonade.
Lemonade! It makes you buff. But seriously, how do you know it's time to switch the dish and get their award-winning voice remote? If you've ever missed kickoff because someone was fumbling with the remote, it might be time to switch the dish! If you think it's weird that finding your favorite teams, movies, or shows means navigating a maze of menus and buttons, it might be time to switch the dish! That's because Dish is different! They're making it easier than ever to get the TV you love! And with the new powerful Dish voice remote, you just say what you want and it's on! With technology like that, it's a better time than ever to switch to Dish! To learn more, call 1-844-CALL-DISH or go to dish.com or visit a local retailer near you! Requires internet connected hopper, other restrictions apply. For full details, call 1-844-CALL-DISH. Dish, tune into you! 145 people on YouTube! I have heat, my balls have lightning in them! YouTube! No, I mean, now we're doing a YouTube commercial! YouTube! See the Jason Ellis Show on YouTube Live! So that exciting. 164! I'm gonna turn into them. What's that do, the count stuff? Remember that guy? He was cool.
Count, yeah.
What happened to him? Or is he still on Sesame Street?
He's the count. Yeah, he's still around. Yeah.
Okay. Is he like, as in like a new episode of Sesame Street, you can catch him now? Yeah,
I believe so. I don't think he's ever gone away. Dude, they've got Elmo up the ass.
Yeah.
Because that guy's that guy's the money maker.
I know, right?
I'm about to do
Elmo. He's the Conor McGregor of Sesame Street.
He really is. It's pretty incredible that they brought, he's like the Cool Ranch Doritos of children's entertainment, that they had a thing that was phenomenally successful. And then the spinoff came along and it actually trumped the original.
Yeah. I remember Elmo coming and he was like really exciting. You know, and then I was like, and then my kids got into it. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you guys, I didn't even realize that he was cool to me.
He's pretty cool. Did you ever see when he plays basketball and he needs to learn the valuable lesson not to talk trash?
Wait, you have to talk trash. Wait, did someone take him to town for talking trash?
No, I think he was pretty good at basketball. And so he started getting a little bit like
cocky,
of an ego about it. You know?
Yeah. What? And then some. Wait, did he dunk?
I don't know what he. I just. Well,
that's him hanging off the rim. So that means that tells me he dunks.
He said.
That's a big leap. 215 people. Fuck off.
He said, "Yeah, boy." To a kid, that was the height.
And he got checked. He got chastised for saying, "Yeah, boy."
Yeah.
Wait, did he throw that from back there?
I don't recall, dude. It's been a while. So he's playing with some kid Miles. I don't even know. I don't even think this is the clip because I seem to recall that he had on some street gear. Like he had on like a cap of some port or something. Some sort of blazer.
It makes sense that he would have a blazer on when he's talking trash.
He's kind of G'd up. Yeah, I have no problem with Elmo. Of all the things I'm going to have to run back in the next couple of years.
Oh, shit. Here it is. Wait. Is this Elmo on Elmo?
Yeah.
Oh! He just what did he say? What did he say when he was hanging off the rim? But I need the audio of the trash talk while he hangs on the rim, man. Oh, he got deep voiced all of a sudden.
That was
unfortunate.
He got Ferris Bueller'd.
But he did dunk.
He did. He's got hops. He jumps very slow.
Yeah. A lot of hang time. No run up either. Just took off.
Not even a step. From the 3-point line to dunk. Impressive.
Yeah, I don't know. You could drive yourself crazy trying to find a particular Elmo clip. He's got a lot of material.
He's a hard-working guy. And so are we, and we're up to 250 people! Man, I should have brought this up ages ago. Anyway, we're going to take a break. We'll be back! Holy shit! Huge! Too bad I only got one fucking camera. People, you want to watch me eat a sandwich? That's right. We are the exciting show. Not just audio, it's a visual thing too. Man, this is ridiculous. Mustache is fucking affecting my eating technique.
I could see that.
I feel like you have to learn how to eat with a mustache. What the fuck? Man, everybody's pumped on it. Like everyone that I have no choice. You know, I have to look a certain way. Like my kids and Katie.
Mm-hmm.
It's impossible to get them all to think that one thing's good.
Mm-hmm.
One likes one, the other hates the other.
Yeah.
Everybody likes my mustache.
Mm.
So I don't really like it. It's just everybody else does. That I see in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Bill Gowrie.
Yeah, but he's back in 15 minutes.
I got to land you. For him. Because I'm such a great guy. Always thinking about other people. Not myself, you know. I don't know what fucking drinks I got.
Two look like iced teas.
No, it's like a peach soda. But it's like, it's just peach juice with fizzy water, so it's not an agave. It's super,
super sweet.
It's like supposed to be healthy, but it's just soda.
Did you order like the hydration sampler and they just send you like... five random things?
No, I just got a chicken sandwich and then I got a bunch of drinks because I'm thirsty and I'm sick of drinking seltzer water, and I was like,
you still have one.
If you don't get a certain amount of shit, then they just charge you. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So I was like, fuck it, I'll just get a bunch of drinks because I know that I can drink lemonade all fucking day. Why is she waiting? Ratchet is on TV still?
I think Ratchet is just on E constantly. She's just an E lady. to support that head. They must have done like a Wolverine adamantium metal injection on her spine and neck.
What is this? Who's Tyler Henry?
No fucking clue. Oh, Hollywood medium.
Yeah, it's the medium guy.
Well, he's probably telling her about her dead ghost relatives.
I assume this is a Seacrest production. All he does.
Cool. So if you watch E, you get to watch Rat Shit cry?
Yeah.
Wow.
Lot of
they're like daytime television. That's like, that's what I saw. I feel like Paul Hogan. Yep, that's what I saw last time I watched TV. Did you know Juliana Ratchet is still on TV talking?
Yeah, I guess I would assume that she was.
I feel like she's one of those people that was like ugly and had got surgery and now is going to be like, when they get real old, they're going to look better.
It takes a toll though when you don't eat for your entire life, when your skin and your hair.
You think that's the case?
Yeah.
So I've got you loaded up with the CD for new music. It is on this fader over here by the mics.
Okay. Who's in on this?
Anybody who wants to sit in, it's just music.
Come in. Let's go.
It's Michael Pye! It's Jason Ellis!
Yeah, man.
Great to be here.
Who are pumped in. It's new and no one's ever done it.
Kelly invented music.
Wow. I was going to say he invented this bit, but yes, he invented music and this bit. Yes. Recently released music by Michael Tully.
And we will begin with Willie Nelson, who I feel like is on every other one of these. I think Willie is pumping material out furiously.
Perhaps. Wow.
What?
Just, you know what I mean? Like, you're, I mean,
him pumping furiously?
I just, no, him, no, I wasn't thinking about that. I am now, thanks. But I feel like his skull is coming out of his face. I can see his skull. You know what I mean? Like, it's like the bone, the body is, I'll know his skull before he dies, because I can see it.
You would be able to identify his remains.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. I'll be able to identify him by his human skull.
Right.
Like the Predator.
But first, may he live long enough to tie his earlobes into that ponytail.
Oh, it can be done. It can and it will be done. He could definitely... He could probably tie them under his neck. I don't know. But yeah, he's a legend and here's his great song.
Yeah, this song, lyrically, is pretty self-explanatory. It's called Last Man Standing.
205 people. The break, we dropped.
Turning into Leonard Cohen. That's pretty bleak.
What do you mean?
Yeah, what are you talking?
My friends are dying. Who's gonna die next?
The fuck else is he gonna write a song about?
He's fucking 90! Yeah! All his friends are dying, and he sounds pretty chipper about it. Really, baby?
And if you'd give the entire chorus a chance...
Yeah, fucking racist. Sorry, I don't know what that meant. If you're in a hurry to die, he ain't waiting. Fuck off.
See?
Yeah, he wants to be the last skeleton standing.
God, can Willie Nelson win with you?
Yeah!
Oh, maybe we should just talk about tying his dangling earlobes behind his head more.
In a rejoicing way. I mean, is this him riffing right now? Because he is fucking it up. That's not him, is it?
I don't think he's his lead guitar player anymore.
But still... I like that
song. Terrific stuff. Yeah. The title track from an album I cannot wait to pre-order, personally.
Yeah. I would like to see a copy of your receipt when you do.
Some people hate Willie Nelson. That person is Kevin Kraft.
Oh, come on now.
If anybody wants to hit him up, it's at Kevin Kraft on something. I don't know.
I would like to smoke weed with him.
Yeah. Man, I wish I could have done something more exciting when it was up to 250 people on YouTube. Should have pulled my nipple out of something. I blew it. Next time.
I saw him smoking weed. I watched that movie Beer Fest finally last night. It's a funny movie.
Oh, it's great.
I never heard anybody talk about that one.
Yeah, well, it's because we saw it all.
Jay Chandrasekhar, who was on the show.
Yeah, he was.
Talked about, in his book, getting stoned with Willie Nelson and how it was just a huge deal for him. And he was like, oh my God, I can't believe this is actually going to happen. And Willie Nelson got him so stoned, he forgot how to behave and got all weird. And he's now like really bummed out that was his one interaction with Willie Nelson. Getting stoned.
Yeah, but I don't think Willie probably sees it that way.
I'm sure Willie has forgotten about it. If it's any consolation to Jay. Speaking of old men making music, Roger Daltrey of The Who has released a solo album. He says Pete Townsend convinced him to do it, so blame Pete for As Long As I Have You.
Fuck you, Pete. Wait, has he got 29 songs on the album?
I don't know if this is the album that this is from. This looks like the back photo from his Greatest Hits album.
Yeah.
Well, good for him. I don't care.
He looks better shirtless than I do.
No, he doesn't. Wow, you really hate yourself, man.
No, I'm just a realist.
Wait, right there you're saying you look he looks better than you.
Yeah, I would trade positions with him. Even with that scar on his stomach. I'll take it.
Why is he? Why does?
I think he's right.
Okay, you're.
Look at that. He is chilling. He doesn't give a flying fuck.
His voice sounds okay. I've never really got The Who. Congratulations to everybody who loves them. But...
That song doesn't offend me.
Yeah, it didn't offend me either. But you're way better looking than him with no shirt on.
I'd prefer to keep my face, but yeah, I'll take his old man body.
I wouldn't
body.
Trade faces. I'm not sure I would trade hair either. He's got a lot of it.
He does have great hair.
Pearl Jam.
Oh, no. I mean, yeah. This could be a quick snippet.
It doesn't sound that Pearl Jam-y to okay, me, good. For whatever it's worth.
I don't hate that, but don't tell my wife I said that.
To me, it sounds like if Sting tried to rock.
It's weird, because Pearl Jam kind of rocked when they first came out, right?
Sting doesn't rock?
Sting does not rock.
He's pretty mellow,
That's
dude.
Pretty fucking... It's pretty harsh, bro.
What's the most rocking thing Sting ever did?
Roxanne is a rock and roll song.
It's a reggae song.
Bullshit!
Besides, that's The Police. I'm talking about Sting.
Oh, okay. Yeah, fuck, yeah, no, okay, he didn't
Free, Free, Set Them Free. To me, this just sounds like a souped-up Free, Free, Set Them Free.
He doesn't like the rock.
I really liked Pearl Jam when they first came out. They had, like, songs that rocked and were cool, and then they just got very slow and boring and depressing, and I couldn't do the Kumbaya Pearl Jam.
I really like Goats, but I don't like Pearl Jam. It's weird.
I don't think he sounds that goaty.
Not anymore.
David Byrne of Talking Heads continues churning out deliriously, delightfully quirky hits in his advancing age. This is called Everybody's Coming to My House.
He's got to be a weird dude to hang out with.
Oh, yeah.
And then you got to go back one.
Sorry. Whoever, that's great. I don't care about that song. I don't care about any of the songs he made.
I feel like if you like Talking Heads, you'd probably like that.
Yeah, okay.
I'm a huge Talking Head fan, and I found that kind of boring.
Oh.
I know the odds are slim, but I would love to see a Talking Heads reunion before they croak.
He looks healthy, Kevin, so I wouldn't be too worried. He looks like he's got 40 left in him.
I think he's doing really, really, like, well. Like, okay. I feel like he's physically in a good place.
Yeah, so I think so, too.
Yeah, but I'm pretty sure their hatred for each other burns... very strong.
Well, he also doesn't need them. You gotta always figure that into it.
He can just do it by himself.
Yeah, exactly. He's gonna have to split whatever percent. Even if he just took half and gave the other half to the rest of the band put together, would he make twice as much from a Talking Heads reunion? I don't know. Plus, then
I'd buy it.
But I also think that he has, at a certain point, this is an underrated thing, these guys like sticking it to their bandmates. Because they know that they hang that over them. Even if he made a little bit less from a David Byrne tour, he can still live very comfortably on a David Byrne tour without having to throw a bone to the other guys.
Oh, yeah. So he still gets to live a comfortable life and motherfuck the other three.
Also, the other ones tried to make a Talking Heads album without him.
Okay, that makes it... that's going to make it hard to get back. When my band does an album without me, I'm pretty bummed out.
He does weird shit, too. Like, I know he was putting on a show that was, like... because he's so fucking artsy that it was, like, high school cheerleaders... Like, he decided that that was, like, a greater art than people realized, so he was putting together, like, shows on stages in Brooklyn and stuff that just had high school cheerleaders in them. And not in, like,
that's not creepy.
No, not in a creepy way. Kind of, like, just admire the art of high school cheerleaders.
Yeah, I don't like old people admiring the art of high school cheerleaders.
Yeah, the art.
I'm not watching a dude with gray hair and a weird blue suit stare at my child who's doing somersaults.
Well, if you prefer very old people, then you might enjoy a solo offering from Derek Smalls... of
fuck yes, he wrote this. I'm one of his biggest fans.
No, skip that again.
Fuck. God damn it.
There we go.
Is he saying he wants his dick in both holes?
No. He's talking about how he's old and washed up and all of the medical procedures that he needs to stay on tour, so it's called MRI.
Oh. Oh my god. Another time for that song, I guess.
Yeah, it's sometimes a joke can't be taken too far. No effects. I don't know this for sure, but they just put out a single and it sure seems like it's about Stephen Hawking to me. And since he owns his own record label, I have this theory that Stephen Hawking died and he wrote a song that day and they recorded it that night and now here it is.
Yes, yeah, well.
There you go, no effects.
Really sticking it to that dead guy.
Yeah.
Take that, smartest man in the world. Pennywise also have a new album. The song is called Live While You Can.
Were they on with Cullen the other day on Faction?
Yeah, I saw a photo of Fletcher with Cullen, so I assume so. Yeah.
That's a good song.
Pennywise, always, as always, evolving with the times. Chameleons of rock and roll.
Fucking asshole.
I like Pennywise. I think they would be the first to admit that they do the Pennywise thing, man.
Okay.
It's cool.
Pennywise thing works.
Yep. Does the Seven Dust thing work?
Let me just bask in that for a little bit.
I mean, I got no hate for Seven Dust, but I like that.
Do they? Oh. 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 Whoa, they got a monster in there.
It's like if a packet of skull could sing.
Right?
It's like a
skull with a bodysuit on. Because he sounds super Living Colour.
Yeah.
He sings like him a little bit.
I feel like it's not as bad as it used to be, but that's a really low bar. Kevin, you seem to appreciate.
No.
I think I know one of those guys.
I just don't, I don't hate Seven Dust.
What's like their,
no, I don't hate
what's
Seven
their signature
Dust
hit?
It was ages ago, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Like the first one they had.
Right, but what is it? Was it a one?
I think
one
I liked it too. I think
it probably was. I had a couple Seven Dust albums growing up. Oh yeah, Denial. That was. Well, I think that was the big one. That was a pretty good
bigger
song.
Bigger than Waffle.
Yeah, I like that.
Was Waffle the one? Or
was Waffle a big hit?
I don't remember Waffle. I'm sure I would remember.
You sure you don't remember it. Waffle? Because Waffle's, you know what I mean, looks like
it's one
big
of the first things that comes up.
Yeah.
Oh, Black. Right? Wasn't that a big thing?
Was it?
I think that was.
I'll tell you which one it was as soon as you play it.
Let's start with Waffle.
Yeah, go with Waffle. Grew up on Waffle.
They're not aging. So good for them. Oh, yeah.
Is it Waffle?
I remember this.
The singer got fat because he's skinny in Waffle. Maybe he ate too many waffles.
Here's the waffles.
He's singing about waffles so much he got chunky.
Fans coming to shows throwing waffles on stage.
Next thing you know,
hates wasting food.
they heard about his incestual passion for waffles.
Waffle. Waffle.
This is not it. Waffle's not it.
I think it's denial.
Try denial.
I think that's the song I remember being like, ooh, I like these guys. Yeah. Check their album out.
Yeah, me too. And then something happened where they didn't do it. They did Waffle, I think. They lost me with the Waffle. But I was in there for, I think I was in there for denial. I know that drummer. I know I've met that dude. I think I've hung out with that dude and got wasted before.
Yeah, I can see that.
He seems super familiar.
Yeah. It's a little dursty.
Yeah, the beep, beep. Was it?
I'm pretty sure just the seven dust was pretty durst, weren't they?
Yeah,
this is very Living Color.
Yeah.
I mean, I hate to do the, you know, black metal singer comparison, but that's very a Living Color.
Yeah.
That's a good tune, though.
It was a good tune.
Yeah.
It was not. It was a little cheesy. But hey,
I'd say that has aged better than most like new metal from that era.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I'm sure
compared
there's
to who.
I'm trying to like think back to like the music I listened to when I first got my license in Jersey.
I mean, Limp Bizkit.
Better than Bizkit.
Yeah.
Everybody's better than AOD. The fuck.
I'm sure there's some Korn songs that seem attached.
Nah, Korn destroys Seven Dust, and you know it.
I don't think Korn were good, but at least Korn were distinctive.
Korn's body of work, there's a couple albums there where they had some rip snorters. I mean, especially when you're talking Seven Dust might only have one song.
their second best song might be Waffle.
Yeah. If we go back down the line and your second rebuttal is Waffle, you'd be benched, son. Okay.
This is Terrence Trent D'Arby, dude.
Yeah. Right? I know, right?
He's super fucking D'Arby.
Man, you're super racist, Michael.
Well, I take back Living Color entirely. He's Terrence Trent D'Arby. He looks like him.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
He's Metal D'Arby.
He is.
Wait, is it D'Arby?
D'Arby did disappear.
And this dude
changed
was
his name.
And when he started, this guy was skinnier. Maybe he just got chunky because of the Waffle song.
Maybe that's what it is.
But is it Terrence?
He's insanely D'Arby'd.
Is Terrence, like, on the map trying to pretend he's still Terrence, or did he disappear? Because we might have just figured out what's going on here.
Terrence,
Lejeune Witherspoon, my ass.
That is your real name?
You're Terrence Trent D'Arby.
Wow. Godsmack had some new shit, too, but I just picked my poison.
Godsmack is terrible. Oh, sorry, but I mean, they are. They're really bad. I mean, your name's Godsmack. You got it from a fucking Ellis and Chainsaw. Give me a break.
Let's see.
Man, he looks like Terrence. That's crazy. But it's not Terrence, right? He's just really like, no, I'm not Terrence.
He officially has always denied being Terrence Trent D'Arby.
I wonder if he thinks I'm racist if I just go, dude, you're Terrence. And he's like, look, we don't all look the same. Wow, Terrence is not. Okay, it's not him.
Nope.
Terrence changed a lot when he got older. What? But wait a minute. Maybe he changed a lot because it's not him.
Yeah. Fake D'Arby.
Fake D'Arby!
It's been replaced by a D'Arby stand-in.
Dang, D'Arby.
Not a
like
very convincing one.
Yeah, D'Arby looks like a snake lady.
No, I'm not buying it.
He also goes by a different name.
I would too.
Yeah, wait, is his name Sandra?
Sananda.
Oh. Dang, he is a complex individual. You know he won't sing those classic hits, no way.
Mm.
He would never play it for you, right? If you're like, hey man, give me that.
You don't think he'd do Wishing Well? I think he'll perform Wishing Well.
I don't think he does Wishing Well.
For food. For waffles.
Now I'm really confused. What's going on? Okay, let's move on.
All right, moving on. Jack White.
Sorry.
This is not the Jack White we have always known and loved.
I don't know Jack White, so nothing's going to surprise me.
Well, do you know what? Very tiny teeth.
He does
not help.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Did his baby teeth not fall out? What happened to that man?
Wow. Well, that is a terrifying thing you pointed out there. Yeah, you're right. He has...
That motherfucker is not eating corn.
Whoa! He grinds like a motherfucker.
That's what that is. He must have gotten a little methy at a certain
point.
He has
all gums.
Yeah, I was at the
holy shit, bro. Can he eat with those?
They're always...
Is he like on a Jell-O diet or what? Because fuck.
Individual kernels of corn.
Right? It's like he does 7 peas for dinner. It takes him 20 minutes to eat them. Holy shit, bro.
Brush his teeth with sandpaper?
If you grind your teeth, that's what happens. My dentist, I was there this morning, they're always warning me about that I'm down to the dentum.
Yeah, yeah, I've gotten that too. Yeah. I've gotten that.
But this
that
guy's warning. Like 30.
Yeah, he's not that young.
I hope he's older than me.
Oh man, some of those ones in the back are not even teeth.
I was listening to White Blood Cells.
He's like a wobbly gong shock.
Red Blood Cells this morning, actually. That album's over 15 years old at this point.
And I like the caption of this photo says Jack White has kitten teeth.
And what an artistic evolution it has been for the one-time white stripe. Check out Ice Station Zebra.
Ugh! Point, 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 point!
Sounds like Beck.
Sounds like Beck. Sounds like Paul's Boutique era Beastie Boys. But somehow worse than both of those things.
I'm going to give it a miss. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Sounds like Rejected Macklemore.
Yeah,
man, there's no word. There's no worse song ever than a Rejected Macklemore. Like... I think I'd rather have AIDS than have a Rejected Macklemore song under my belt. That's the most offensive thing I've ever heard you say. 114! We're still alive!
Weird Al?
Oh, come on, man!
So he doesn't...
Can him and R. Kelly, like, have a headbutt fight to the death?
I love Al. I wanted to go see
him. I know, but stop making music.
I wanted to go see him on his tour. Up. He's actually doing a tour now, and he, by his own admission, it's a very vain thing that he's doing that nobody's going to like. He's just touring doing his original songs, because he's always had original songs. They're also silly, but he's just doing one tour for his life where he doesn't have to do somebody else, like Michael Jackson songs.
Yeah.
But for some reason, he has an album at the same time that includes songs that aren't his own, including this polka version of the musical Hamilton.
Okay, I gotta do that. That's insane.
Don't worry, I got something completely different for you now. Hard to believe it has been 17 years since Squirrel Nut Zippers blessed the world with a new album of original material. But they are back with Carnival Joe from Kokomo. Remember when we were all into swing? Remember when we used to all wear the swing clothes and do swing dancing?
Yeah.
Well, these daddy-os do.
They didn't
these
stop.
Guys never stop.
Yeah. Are these original members of the Squirrel Nut Zippers?
Do you know anybody who wanted to join the Squirrel Nut Zippers?
I just feel like you could totally replace all of them and no one would know. Or is it like, am I missing out? Does everybody know who all these guys are? What the fuck is...
That's like New Orleans music.
Okay, Shay, I reckon that's a shit song.
Making Brian Setzer look tasteful by comparison.
Squirrel Nut Zippers.
Yep, that's classic Zippers. They're back, baby.
Oh, it was popular demand. That's what happens.
Your dancing shoes. Here yep. come the zippers.
Out your rusty trombone.
The crowds wanted it. Here they come.
Segueing into recently released hip-hop, Big Timers are... I guess these guys have been on the outs with each other for a while.
Yeah, oh, Birdman yeah? seems to have a lot of feuds.
Yeah, with Manny Fresh and shit like that, but then they made...
You know, people keep disrespecting him.
He must be a very bitchy man.
How does he say it? What did he say when he talked to that Charlemagne guy? Yeah. That's what it was.
So there's a documentary about, what's the name of the label?
Cash Money?
Is it? No, it's not.
Yeah, I think they're Cash Money.
It is Cash Money? Okay, yeah. So it's a Cash Money documentary, and so him and Manny Fresh made a new song for that documentary. And here it is, called Designer Caskets.
Yep, that's
Big Timers.
That's a song about people that have a lot of money and kill people.
Yeah, meanwhile, for Sean Paul, it's all about the love.
No, he's back! Yeah! Oh! All day, baby, in the club, bottle service. You'd be getting on that. You'd be grinding some bitches right there. You know what I'm saying? Come on, Cool Beans. This is... You're still young enough.
I am not.
I'm telling you. These are the songs where you get laid.
He's really from Jamaica?
Fuck yeah. Jean-Paul's all
real. What
are
you talking about?
How dare you?
I mean, is he really like, from Jamaica?
Yes, he's really from Jamaica. Dude. Why are you casting...
Yeah.
Aspersions.
Yeah, he brought that shit over here. He's the...
Why do you suspect he is or might not be Jamaican?
Yeah.
I don't know. He must have,
I mean, listen to his accent.
I mean, there's no way that could be put on. I don't know. I don't get it. I don't get Sean Paul.
Why do you think he is not Jamaican?
I don't know. Doesn't seem like there's a lot of white dudes in Jamaica.
He's not white.
What is he?
He's pretty light-skinned, but I don't think he's white.
Man.
Look at that guy.
That's not a white guy?
No, it's not a white guy! He's Jamaican, man.
He says "mon" all the time. Super Jamaican.
He's "mon" is one of his songs.
For all I know, he's saying it every third word.
He does say it every third word, man. What?
He's a black kid.
His paternal grandfather is from a Jewish family that had immigrated from Portugal, and his paternal grandmother was Afro-Caribbean. His mother is English and Chinese Jamaican. So yeah, he's black.
Okay. Fuck me.
He's black as shit.
I retract my previous statement. I was way off.
Duh. Chinese, Portugal. I mean, he's black as fuck, right?
Yeah. He's from Jamaica.
Yeah, man.
That's really embarrassing. I really put my foot in my mouth.
Yeah, no. He's one of the greatest artists of our time. Jean-Paul is back.
Misunderstood in so many different ways.
Oh, no. My daughter knows who this kid is.
A Xanax boy?
Yeah. Fuck, man. Once again, sorry to go on this killing spree today, but I'll kill him too. He's not good for the kids. We don't need him on the planet.
It doesn't look like he's got much time left.
Just don't like it.
We're not gonna do Lil Xan? You sure you don't want more of that?
That's Jay-Z.
Wait.
Oh shit, did we get on that one?
Yeah.
Oh.
Oh my god, you're right. Well, that's not Jay-Z, but yeah, Jay-Z is on that track. Yeah.
Wait, so what am I playing right now?
You're playing the new DJ Khaled track that has
Jay-Z. Jay-Z. And...
What?
This is huge.
That stuff is really, that style of rap is really stupid to me, but Jay-Z trying to do it is even stupider.
Wait, is that him? I thought that was somebody else doing the...
No,
he's not. There's no way he...
So you think Jay-Z just stopped rapping for a second and let someone else do a really throated...
But that's what Kalehead does.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow, that sounds really stupid.
Yeah, they're all idiots.
Remember when you rapped with Andrew and you were just yelling things in the background? It's like that.
I could do that.
It's RRT, SKRRTT.
Stop. They're just like, fuck it, just say anything, man.
It yeah. literally does not matter.
Because it's all new. Like, the new guy that's come out, he's got like a fucking rainbow hair dye, and he's just like, and your Jay-Z has been in the game for 30 years, yeah. and you're like, you flinched the first time, for sure. Yeah. You're like, what the? Screw's gonna, okay, well, I'm on the Maybach, and this dickhead's gonna be up behind you just lit up, because he's all excited, he just got, you know, he's now the coolest rapper in the game, and he's got his new shit, and Scar! In the fucking back, in Jay-Z's ear, who's just like made this shit, and now he's gonna be in a music video with some wasted fucking 20-year-old in the back going, hey! Oh!
It sounds like they got the bird from the Flintstones, they're just stomping on its foot.
It's not, it's all, they ripped off the Birdman. Birdman did the brrr, and that's it. It's the extension of brrr.
Which was actually pretty solid.
It was!
Yeah. And then we have some new metal beginning with the Sword.
Pretty cool.
It's all right. Kevin, you disagree?
I'm not into the stoner metal stuff. It's a little boring for me.
Fair enough.
But these guys look like they might be able to fix my laptop.
Dang.
Harsh.
The Sword by night, IT by day.
Napalm Death.
Yes!
Oh, they're not fixing my laptop.
Breaking it down. These guys order so much at Taco Bell when they go there. They go fucking hard. Like, they go, they riff at it and they go to Taco Bell.
The diarrhea starts before they finish eating all
the one guy that's bald with, like, this weird, like, it's the weird, he has, like, hair, but it's, man, he is the gnarliest dude ever. There's one guy in the band that's, like, a big fat old man, and he's bald, but he's got... He's kept his hair since, you know, obviously he's had this hairdo since back in the day, but it's so thin in the middle that he has like a part, but instead of a part, it's a receding part line. You can see his whole skull. He's like a big, fat, angry clown. Like, he doesn't have the makeup on, but the hair is super clowny. He's like, really? He looks like, he might be on, I mean, his diet is really bad. And he was old in the 90s. Yeah, he's a weird guy.
He's the... I think he's the longest existing member of the current Napalm Death lineup.
Oh!
Shane Embury.
Oh, they're not all... Oh, man, that haircut is insane.
They actually... They don't have any original members left.
Oh.
Like, they did Scum, and then I think Harmony Corruption, and then switched singers.
Right, you've said this before, right? But they've had the same guy for a very, very long time.
Yes.
Like, Bruce Dickinson's not the original singer of Iron Maiden, but if for some reason you were touring around and he was the only guy in Iron Maiden, it's not like some big fraud.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, this has been the lineup for decades, and that song is off of... They're putting this 90-minute double album of... That song is new, but then it's all these B-sides, because they always over-record, and then they throw, like... bonus tracks on Japanese releases or out of print EPs, so it's like 90 minutes of all that, and then I think they're putting out an entirely new album as well.
Man,
these guys shred for how old they are.
I say this all the time, but like, if I pull out one of their albums from 10 years ago and I point to like track 12 and I'm like, you guys play that right now. There's no fucking way that they remember that one from all the other ones, is it?
I don't know. They might. I mean, this is this one these where
guys... Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah,
I mean, these guys, they never stop. They're constantly touring, constantly putting out new music.
He looks like he's constantly shitting, too. He's
constantly going to
Taco Bell. Yeah, Taco Bell with a slight leak out of his ass the whole time. Just... with, like, just turds leaking into the pouch of his undies. On set. His buddy's like... just humming out turds into his diaper. So fucking metal. Love those guys.
Is that Amorphis?
Wait, oh.
Nope, that was
still doing the death. All right.
Yeah. Okay, good. Now who are we playing?
Amorphis.
Amorphis! I hate that. I hate when they do that.
You don't like... noodling?
No.
Keyboards.
Keyboards.
Oh.
Thank you, Michael. I love a noodle. Don't get me wrong. I love a noodle. Just keyboard metal, man. What the fuck?
It's very Final Countdown.
Yeah. And that was only one song that got away with it. No one can ever get away with that again. That song, that video was amazing, too.
I don't remember the music video for Final Countdown.
They were, like, on stage, and it was, like, sound checks. There was no crowd or whatever, and they fucking did the big... in the sun and shit.
There ever another metal song that really worked with keyboards? It depends on whether or not you want to count Faith No More as metal.
What?
Of course I would.
You do.
Okay,
yeah.
I would. Then their entire catalog.
But they didn't over. They didn't push it over the top.
A lot of times he was playing like piano and stuff too. It wasn't these dumb digital synthy things.
Yeah. Yeah, I hate that shit.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, okay.
I think
that's
if you do
shit.
It right, if you can work keyboards into like that melodic metal like that, it doesn't always work. But I like Amorphis. I like Children of Bodom. I like Soilwork.
And they all do that.
Soilwork doesn't lean on it as heavily as they used to, but Children of Bodom they still got that because the guy plays it like they angle the keyboard straight up, so he like dangles his fingers and plays it, and just
okay.
Shreds. They put an effect on it that makes it sound like an electric guitar. It works for me. I get that it's kind of corny, but I don't know. I still like hearing it.
Next. I'm not saying they ain't good musicians and shit. I'm just... that's a certain pitch that... as soon as I hear it, I'm like, I'm out.
Yeah, I kind of feel the same way.
Dark Tranquillity, they're another good band that works them in sometimes.
I get confused because of the power and speed and keyboard. It's just like... it's like, it's a little bit Al Yankovic, almost. It's like, why would you do that when you had that riff going, and why would you make fun of it by putting that over it? But I get it. Who's next?
Next to last, Dimmu Borgir.
Oh, wait. Are these guys the guys that are in Greenland that they ate, they bring meat onto the stage?
Meat.
Katie said some band brings like all meat carcasses on stage so you can smell them. They smell like dead meat. That's their thing.
I've seen Dimmu Borgir a couple times live, and I've never seen them bring out meat.
Okay. See, I would go see these guys, and I don't really like what they're doing right there, but I do get it though. It's like I would go watch them because I think it's funny. You know,
the keys sit in this a little bit more sensibly.
Yeah, it's still dark. Like the keys are still dark with it. They sound satanic.
They're pretty evil.
Yeah, but I would never listen to that in the privacy of my own house because I'd be like, stop singing like that with it. It's weird.
Yeah,
but look at them. They look entertaining as fuck.
Yeah, they put on a good show. I like their older stuff. This operatic thing isn't really doing much for me.
Oh, they didn't sing like opera before?
No, they're more like black metal, but they have a lot of like the keyboards and the synthy like organy stuff going.
Oh, then I might like the older stuff because that's probably the only bit I wasn't that into.
You probably would. It's pretty solid.
Cool boots, though.
I don't know what they're doing.
I respect a man with studded boots that go past his knee.
They are very spiky. If you got a hug from them, you did.
They're fucking awesome. Those boots are sick. Okay, who else?
And finally, Christian metal at its finest.
Striper
is still going.
Well, of course, they don't drink. Oh, sorry.
I sampled a couple songs from this album that's coming out, and yeah.
You like it?
It's not bad.
The one guy's in Tiger Box.
What?
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
The guitar player in the last Tiger Box is the guitar player from Striper.
No!
Yeah. Remember I told you that the band politely asked, they said, do whatever you want to do on stage, it's fun, we get it, we love it, but the one guy's in Striper, so if you keep the girls away from him.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's confusing.
Right.
He had a wife or something, right?
He's in Striper. They're a Christian metal band.
But I didn't get that until right now.
Yeah, this album is called Goddamn Evil. Get it? They're telling God to damn
evil. Yeah, I know, yeah. I can't. Alright. Holy
gotcha.
Shit.
Gotcha. Not feeling that one?
Not at all. No. They sound like they're playing on PVs.
Yeah, it is a little PVE. It was always a little PVE. I heard that song, their big radio hit, Honestly, the power ballad.
Yeah.
And it's weird, because it came out in like 89, and even then it sounded like Styx.
Yeah, they sound teeny and weak. Will, come in! How are you, Will?
Alright, how are you?
Oh man, I'm fucking, you know, me.
Awesome!
It's always great to be me.
It's very humid in here.
Yeah, it is too hot.
It's like,
But he hasn't taken his hoodie off, so it's not that odd.
A little bit of rainforest kind of thing going on.
I mean, you can turn it...
You could grow tomatoes in here.
Andrew, can you make it a little...
flowers.
Can you make it a little cooler? I was going to wait for Telly. I think it's warm.
If you think it's warm, it's warm.
Because of my temperature thing?
Yep.
I'm good. I'm in the middle. I could just as easily take this off and I'd be fine.
Maybe it's just coming in from the ice box into the oven.
See, that's the thing that I have to stop. And if it does happen when I go out there today, mm-hmm. I'm not coming back in here anymore. Because that's how you get sick. If it's real warm in here and it's freezing out there... And I have to get the chills when I walk through there. I'm not coming here anymore.
Didn't Aubrey say the exact opposite thing yesterday? He said, you know, everybody goes out in the cold and they think, oh, you're going to get a cold or whatever, and that's not true.
That the exact opposite is true. It's actually revitalizing.
Hey, wait, don't you go into like a freezer, an actual freezer, to repair your body?
That's right. Maybe the green room is not cold enough.
Mmm.
Yeah, like I said, I'm not coming here anymore.
I mean, honestly, when I was in here yesterday, the day before, I was sweating. I was sweaty from...
It's too hot in here. I don't know why anybody turned it up. I just don't want the green room to be freezing. I can't get anything across. Just let me do it, all right? Just let me do the... Every time I come in, I'll do that, and that one, and that one. Because fuck, man. Right.
Your right wheel goes off the road.
But I can't tell.
And then you overcompensate and swing hard to the left. And
I don't understand it. It's not that technical, man. Just a normal kind of temperature. Nothing drastic.
Your truck jackknifes.
But it has not... That's the new thing now. It's one room's freezing and one room's warm. I don't know. I can't... There's nobody to call. I can't stop.
There's always something going on.
I don't...
It's kind of fun. I'm excited to see what the next thing is. Can I promote something?
Yeah, fuck yeah, man.
Today's the day when I have crossed the very last thing off my bucket list of life.
Would you like me to kill you now?
They're all dead.
After I finish promoting it. I am, officially today, I have become a cartoon character.
Fuck yeah, I'm Wilton Darby! Hey! Yep. That's fucking awesome.
So...
What's your name?
I don't know. But, I'm three different characters on the show.
Yeah!
And it's a cat agent. If you go to VRV, look at episode 8 of the second season of Cat Agent, and I'm on there.
Is VRV a website?
Yeah, it's a YouTube thing where nice. They do a lot of animation stuff.
Can we enjoy your work?
I know!
Really fucking cool.
I want to watch Cat Agent.
Yeah.
Oh, Cat Agent looks cool, too.
Alec Baldwin's cat?
Or yeah, that's
season one.
That's season one.
Oh, it's mature.
Oh, yeah, no, it's...
Rules a frisky guy, so yeah.
It's got a lot of dirty stuff.
See, yeah, I heard the rumor you did full frontal nudity for this.
Yep. See, that thing says season one, you want to drag that down to season two. And it's the last episode right there. Oh, it's pre-Mew.
Cat String Mew Mew.
You didn't sign up.
Oh, shit.
Oh.
But I'll show it to you guys.
Yeah, I think you would. It's cool. Show you very funny.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. What's the deal with Cat Agent?
Mm-hmm. It's just some cartoons some people put together.
Well, obviously, but what's the... Tell me more.
It's a really, really realistic show about what agents are like in Hollywood, except they're cats.
I've watched a couple of clips of this in Will's office, and it's very funny.
Mm-hmm. It's good.
Well, that's great.
It's by a guy that wrote like the a bunch of SpongeBob episodes and a cartoon called Flapjack, and also worked on Adventure Time.
All right, well, I'm going to take a break.
All my life. Now you can murder me.
I wanted to show you this too, Will. I was at some extremely bizarre restaurant in Japan.
Wow, that's so bizarre.
And there was some Adventure Time toys.
That's crazy.
Adorning it.
That's awesome. I would think that show would do well over there.
Oh. I got you, Larry. This truly is the best day of my life. Thank you. Why is it so cold in here? To me, this is not cold, but...
I can't remember how to go to the bathroom, but I should be back before
okay.
Flows over.
Is the next thing, is the...
Love note.
Okay.
So we'll each come in for the love note.
Yeah.
Here.
Pussy, do you?
No, I do.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I actually fucking I love.
You rest your mustache on there, obviously.
I get in there. I could never do the open mouth policy.
You say you get right in there.
Yeah, right in there.
Do you lick her at all, or are you just tongue darting her in the vagina?
Pretty much just a tongue dart.
Wow.
You're all a face fucker.
All the good stuff's on the inside.
Yeah. Yeah, I get in there.
Get in there and tongue them giblets.
Oh, come here more.
We're here every day, Harley.
Spring has sprung and love is in the air. In Fort Myers, Florida, a 60-year-old woman got married to a 100-year-old ficus tree.
That's a tree, right?
I was yes. with you up until you said ficus.
Well, they were going to cut it down, Will. She had no choice.
Oh, she saved it by marrying it.
She wanted to draw attention to how greedy real estate developers are going to... They said, you know, they already lost a bunch of trees there because of the hurricane, and then these people want to cut this one down because it is putting shade on some rich person's property. And so she thought if she married the tree, the community would rally around her. And indeed, several people showed up at town hall when she had a sort of ceremony to proclaim her love for... the tree.
Wait. Well, someone's got to tell her it's not legal until they consummate the marriage. She's gonna have to fuck that fucking thing.
You might say the same thing to another woman who is planning to marry the game Tetris.
Wait, the person that married the tree, did she save the tree?
So far.
Okay. Marrying a game, yeah. Like, I make sense. I feel like these days people realize that, you know, men are pigs. And if you can figure out a way to live without them, you're better off. And I feel like, you know, I mean, when you're old and, you know, I mean, you're, you know what I mean, like, ugly and shit, you see even more so how gross we are, because we're probably not even, like, opening the door for you or something, because we're, you know what I mean, we're not even interested in having sex with you. So you're like, fuck you, I'm going to marry a fucking video game.
I wonder which Tetris shape is her favorite.
Does she have a mustache?
Probably the one that looks like a cock and ball.
She likes a sideways T.
Does she have a fucking mustache?
Yeah. If you would say that Prince did, then I would say that she does.
What's the hip hop? What was that hip hop guy that had the fake nose? The boom? The Humpty?
And Humpty. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
She looks like Humpty.
Digital Underground?
Yeah, she looks like Digital Underground.
She looks like a less well groomed Alfonso Ribeiro.
Yeah.
Do you think she's just.
El DeBarge.
Singer John Cicada.
Like, does she want to marry the cartridge or the actual game? Because, like, is she gonna like put the game on the TV, Donald Duck it, and then just like spread her legs beneath the TV?
Why do you? All those blocks why do you have to always put sex with love? That's what you're missing here, Kevin. She just loves the game so much that she wants to marry it. There's no sex involved.
If I tried to tell a girl I love you so much I don't want to fuck you, she would be pretty confused. But probably
you,
upset.
You love metal. But do you fuck it?
She would be relieved.
It's not the marriage love the question. I have for metal. She's taken it so far. She's going to marry the game. But there's sex with, you don't involved
think,
with marriage.
You don't think that people... Well, dude, that's
says
ridiculous.
Someone has never been married.
I know. Wait till you get... have a kid and see how many blowjobs you get. You can't... People get married all the time when they're old, like people that have like their wife dies and the other person's husband dies, and then they get married and they don't fuck because their genitals don't work. They love each other. They probably like.
Well, judging by her mustache, she's not too far off from puberty, so she's not an old person.
No, but the old lady married the tree.
She has to fuck it.
The tree is 100 years old.
Fuck that tree.
Why do you keep putting fucking in it? Why can't you just marry somebody and live with them and love them? I mean, when you think about how long you actually fuck compared to all the rest of the time you spend with them.
That's right.
Not to mention, like, one day probably not me, but will not want to fuck as much.
People go to therapy for sexless marriages.
Yeah, but that's people that
really... It's a problem.
But that's people that want to have sex. There's people that love it, that don't want to have sex. I've had people call the show, and I know that they're like, "This, my husband won't fuck, my wife won't fuck," and I'm like, if I could get those two people that want to fuck to meet... the person that wants to fuck in the other relationship, because like my wife didn't want to fuck me, and that's what happened. We left each other, but that's not. She wasn't a bad person. She just didn't want to have sex all the time, upside down, different angles, like I did. You're annoying me with your sex, and I was like, you're annoying me with your not sex.
Well, this lady, she seems to be posing very provocatively with her Tetris cartridge.
Well, maybe that's because. If you could free your mind a little bit,
nope.
She is attracted to objects, not people.
Well, do you think she blows in the cartridge before she shoves it up her ass?
Oh my god!
Why does it keep coming on things?
How did it come on?
Why is it coming on the cartridge?
You think she gets wet when she hears the game? I mean, like the song?
Yes, I
don't. Tchaikovsky?
I'll go with that.
But that is cool, because, I mean, everybody wants to marry the Statue of Liberty or whatever. She is marrying a concept.
You love comic books. Would you ever jerk off to a comic book?
No.
Oh, dude.
Tetris will never
come
leave
on.
Her.
Yeah, but you don't have to.
You've
stop.
Never done
See,
that.
See, Andrew, you're coming on everything, too. What can't you just love? Like, I love.
I jerked off to an anime when I was a kid.
I love my dope.
Why don't you marry it?
I love my dope. I love all my every dope I've ever had. I love it.
But to be
it's
fair,
not romantic
you've
love.
Had sex with all your dirt.
I've had my skateboard in bed with me before. When I was a skateboarder all the time.
Did you do it for good luck?
No, I just love my skate. Sometimes I'd set up skateboards and they'd be like really perfect. And I'd be like, this one.
I slept with a basketball for years growing up. Oh, and a football.
Okay. In his ass.
Did you just like sleep in a Chuck E. Cheese ball pit full of all your different sports balls?
No. Nope. Just those two.
I'm gonna get on Andrew's side here. Listen here, nerd boy. Like, it's not all about just fucking different balls to throw.
Yeah, just because sports balls hate you. You don't hate them.
Well, I didn't know how deep this goes. It started out with, I slept with my basketball. And my football. I didn't know if they're throwing some pucks
in there.
No,
because you're
that's
the one.
Where the golf balls went.
You're the one that wants to have sex with everything you like. We're not doing that. We can just love stuff and not have our penis involved in it.
I know I'm a giant weirdo and I have sex with the people I'm in relationships with. But
so I've heard.
There might be a couple other people listening that also have sex with their significant others.
I'm well aware of that, but I don't think you believe that there's a person out there that loves somebody and doesn't fuck them. And I think that what I'm trying to tell you is there's more out there of them than you know.
You I mean,
I guess
your
if
mom.
You're if you're such a fucking wackadoodle that you're marrying a cartridge, maybe your idea of sex. You don't get horny like everybody else does.
Well, she said she enjoys a physical relationship with Tetris objects. So, maybe she holds the cartridge in her hand while she diddles herself. She says she sleeps with Tetris pillows as well. I mean, maybe there's something that she can rub on herself.
I knew a guy that fucked a toaster. Used to make fun of him all the time.
Tetris makes her hot, man.
Every time she clears a line in the game, it's like a mini orgasm?
Yes. That's exactly what it's like.
You're pretty mean. You're a pretty mean person. Pretty mean, close-minded person. Which is crazy because I'm totally in love with you.
Interesting.
Right?
This is news to me.
Is it?
Yeah.
A lot of sexual tension in this room.
I wrote a letter about it.
You want to play some Tetris?
You want to hear it?
Yeah.
All right. Because it's real.
Oh, my God.
I'm already half-chubbed.
All right.
You...
I wrote it.
Wrote a love note to Kevin?
Yeah, I did. Kevin, you're super hot, bro. You're like a fat tranny who lost her wig. I dig it, man. I want to suck your fat tits and jizz in on your comic books. And then I want to beat gays with you because I know you're a total homophobe. I was hoping we could find... Some new mold in your new apartment and we could snort it together and fart each other's dicks out. I love you, Kevin.
That was very sweet.
That is beautiful.
I was not expecting that, and it's a little bit awkward because I also just wrote a love note, but to Tully.
Oh,
no. So.
Well, because that's not... Yeah,
in your face.
What a burn. That's like when Drew told me I was too white for his show. Like, I am just getting destroyed.
But don't worry, Jason, because I wrote you a love note.
Fuck! God damn it!
So if you want me to read my love note to you, Jason,
yeah,
I can go ahead.
Kevin, also, I have some bad news for you.
Oh, no! This is really weird. We should have done this on a Friday so we could have, like, a weekend to recover.
I know, right?
You guys are all gay.
Finally. You got it, Will.
Alright, I'll go ahead. Jason.
Oh my god.
Yeah, don't look at me.
I can't.
You enter...
That's how all of my love letters start.
Look away.
Don't look at me.
I write that on the envelope.
I'm gonna fucking do that to my wife. Don't look at me. I got something to tell you.
Don't look.
Like I said, don't look.
Don't look at me.
I fucking love you. All right. You're super pretty and shit.
Close your eyes.
Right, I'm out of here. I said, close your eyes. Get my YouTube back up, everybody, because you're going to see Andrew camera in his face.
Jason.
Yes, Andrew, yes.
You enter the studio every day, and the masculine musk infiltrates my nostril, the strut and confidence of a model. I turn up the studio temperature just to see you sweat.
Fucking asshole.
The beads dripping down your chest stir my rocket. My erection lasts 3 hours, and I should see a doctor. But the antidote is not a pill. It's your returned affection. You play hard to get, and I see that. This tug of war on my heart is just foreplay combat. And one day when the satellites crash and burn, Jace Cakes and Hightower will be left with no concern. Our loads will fly across each other, just one after another. So Jason, stop playing hard to get. It doesn't matter to me you don't know the alphabet. Our love will transcend the spoken word. You can't hurt me now. I won't be deterred.
Turd.
I know the alphabet.
That's so weird. You just said his musk enters your nostril?
Yeah, I've got a broken nose. Only one works.
Me too.
That's beautiful. Nice subtext.
I didn't realize that was supposed to rhyme, like the last three lines.
No, but,
that wasn't all supposed to rhyme, was it?
Everything lined except one.
I didn't catch the rhyming until the end,
too. Can you tell us the one that didn't quite rhyme?
My erection lasts 3 hours, and I should see a doctor.
Which is worth it, because I don't care if that rhymes. That's the best line of the rhyme.
So that was the first line, and then I couldn't figure out what to rhyme with doctor when I wanted to go with the line, but the antidote is not a pill, it's your returned affection. So doctor and affection don't rhyme.
You thank correctly you. Identified true. That, yes.
Affection true. And erection might have, but...
Thanks for breaking that down.
Yep, okay, that would have worked.
Who wants to fuck?
You know what? I'm sorry that you want to do that, Andrew, because I love you.
Oh!
You knew it.
And I've written...
Gross, but I always knew it.
A little note here for you.
Will's got a love boner.
My darling Andrew, I am longing for you, my dear. My little Mr. Winkles longs to feel your big dumb caress. Oh, to walk in the moonlight, my arm around your knees. Oh, for us to dance cheek to belt buckle, to run my fingers through your gorgeous, luscious skin. For us to lay in bed together and spoon like a souvenir collectible Kentucky State spoon Grandma bought at Stuckey's on a road trip in a giant industrial ladle. That is why I hath writ this poetry for thine masturbatory purposes.
Holy shit.
A is for your ass cheeks, tan and perky. N is for you naked on the floor. D is for your dainty darling dick, dear. R is for the rough stuff, you big whore. E is for the fact that you are eager. And willing is the letter W. But of all the letters I can gather, the important ones are I, N, U.
Sweet yet horrific.
I-N-U.
Oh, yeah, I didn't get that. I thought you were calling him the N-word. I was like,
what?
I'm like, what the fuck's going on
here? No.
So it was your dick going into his butt.
Yes, okay. Exactly.
All right. You get it. Just wanted to clear that up.
Right. Butt fucking in the end.
Right.
Got it.
Well, it appears that my love for Will will therefore be unrequited.
Oh, boy.
Man, everybody got turned in, huh?
I wrote a note. Not that you care.
I know.
How to put into words the language of the heart. 15 years have passed in the blink of an eye since we crossed paths. I have savored every moment. First you were my boss, then my mentor, a tender yet firm hand teaching me how to promote the new episode of Kelly Slater's Radio Chaos. And to proclaim to the world my love for an insane mix of rock, punk, and beats. A work relationship became a friendship, and then, in a heady swirl of emotions, blossomed into love. When I hear your voice, I taste ice-cold sweet tea on a hot Alabama afternoon.
Oh my God, I'm gonna throw up.
When I look into your eyes, I can see my future. Will, you sure know how to fill out a Dickie's button down, but I'm more interested in the Dickie in your pants.
That's beautiful.
You have something my wife could never offer me. A cock. Oh, Captain, my Captain, I want you to slay me with your fuck hammer. Endlessly, relentlessly. Then I want to stuff you full of my throb monster so that, if fate would allow it together, we can raise a butt baby. I hope it has your shins. Love, Tully.
Oh, wow, that's beautiful.
Well, I mean, that's just going to make this all the more awkward. Because not only am I in love with you, Tully,
yeah,
we also doubled up on the line, so...
What?
Are we also making a butt baby?
Yeah.
Oh, no!
Dearest Tully, I've noticed an exchange in glances recently after trading spicy on-air zingers, and I want you to know that, yes, I feel it too. I prefer we act discreet, as I don't want to generate any jealousy with the other guys in the office. But we should get together sometime soon, just the two of us. Maybe we can meet up at my place someday. Throw back a few beers to loosen up. Play a few rounds of Strip Mario Kart and see where it takes us. Is there anything specific you want to do to me? I'll tell you some of the things that I would like to do to you. I'd like to lay you down on a bed of roses by candlelight. I want to drive my face between those luscious ass cheeks and go bobbing for berries. I want to mash our pee holes together until we get suction and have to pull apart like a Chinese finger trap. Our combined Irish genitals will be a force of nature. I'd pound you in the ass, but I don't want your wife to stumble upon your ruined butthole and get suspicious. So you should probably just pound mine. I know I make a lot of jokes about pooping and farting, but trust me, my ass is just fine. I don't know if you've ever done some gay shit before, but if it helps, we can draw a pussy around my asshole so it doesn't seem too foreign. You can get me pregnant with your leprechaun butt babies, and I'll raise them in secret, far from everyone's judgy eyes. Or we could just keep it simple, and I'll straight up suck your schlong. Maybe I'm reading too far into this. Maybe there isn't something there, but if I'm right, and I think I am, let's fucking do this. Circle yes or no. XOXO, Kevy Kev.
Oh, wow.
I feel like your the style of your love note writing has been influenced by all the time you've spent on Craigslist.
A little bit, right? I caught that too.
Super Craigslist-y.
Yeah, I caught that too.
I like the yes, no, maybe thing, you know? That gives them an out.
It has sharpened me into a fine pervy tool.
Too bad it's gone.
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
Can't believe they ruined it.
It really is fucked up.
Yeah, right? Another beast will raise its ugly head to take its place.
What about all the...
Or maybe that law will be repealed.
All the dating sites. Do they have... Is there new dating app sites that have... You know what I mean? Like they put messages out there as well? Because I think I went on a bunch of them for a day. Like somebody made a joke. Like go on all of them and see if you can hook up with chicks as well. But there's got to be one where they say stuff about them. You know? Mm. Like you don't just like swipe or whatever the hell the... dating site usually does. Like it's like, hey, I'm into this and I'm into that, and if you like, you know, in shards of glass in your ass, hit me up. Like there's got to be an app that has a little more detail on the person.
I mean, you just need online romantic personals, but it seems like this, the new law that was passed, if you know anybody misuses your website for something illegal, it's you who will face the charges. So well, they were just like, fuck it, we're not doing that.
Exactly. But I feel like anytime you make the case one way or the other, it sounds outrageous, and you kind of have to pick one or the other.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you say, oh, so now I have to be responsible for any single person who posts anything. I have to know what they're really up to. How would I possibly... That sounds ridiculous. But on the other hand, we go, hey, dude, it's obvious that there's some amount of sex trafficking that's going on because of your site.
you need to be responsible for the shit that goes on your fucking site. Yeah. You can't just play dumb and take the money and go, yeah, that's right.
But
well, which one do you want to pick?
If I get a van and go pick up somebody or, like, you know, Buffalo Bob or whatever them, you know, the Ford Motor Company is not responsible for that. They make vehicles that people could lure people into.
Yeah, like I say, you can choose either side of it, but I think we generally... Okay, there's a story going around today about YouTube, where apparently... Now, I never came across this stuff when my dude... He's not really on YouTube anymore, but when he did spend some time there when he was a really little kid, kids just click on whatever fucking video they want to watch, and then most people have their YouTube set up. YouTube constantly resets itself to autoplay. It just goes into the next thing, and you just go into this wormhole. And some people, everybody's guilty at some point or another of just getting distracted doing your shit, or wanting to take a 15-minute break from your kid, or wanting to take a shower, or whatever. And it doesn't take that long for YouTube, apparently, to get into some really, really creepy videos for children. Minnie Mouse videos with suicide, cannibalism, the Paw Patrol committing suicide.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I have never actually seen this stuff, but YouTube is just not responsible for what's on YouTube.
Yeah, well, you gotta be careful. I mean, you know, like trying to show, like, when my kid was younger or something, like trying to show him a SpongeBob thing, and all of a sudden they start going, ah, fuck, you know, or whatever right. in the middle of it, because somebody's replaced the audio. You just have to know what's there. You gotta watch it first or something.
I don't understand why you would let your little kid surf.
I wouldn't.
YouTube.
I wouldn't. I don't care.
I don't care what he's... You're not doing it.
No.
You're not on the internet. Why do kids need to be on the internet? You know? You get a video and then you play it for them. And they get a little old and they start surfing it. I'm telling you, the first thing they type in there, they'll find tits and dicks pretty quick. As soon as they realize that it's the internet, it's like, what's the thing that I'm not allowed to see?
In fifth grade, me and my friends would look up dirty words in the dictionary.
Right.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have an internet.
Right. You find something because you want to learn. And, so I feel like it's just one of those things where parents, you talk about it a little. It's hard to know when, though. You know, you don't want to bring it. For me, it's hard. You know, I'm talking to my kids about taking drugs because I'm not sure about when they all take them. I'm absolutely positive my daughter's not taking drugs, but I got to bring it up. And I'm like, if I bring it up, is this now an introduction to drugs? Did I just introduce her to it? I'm like, nah, she listens to all those stupid rappers. So she
People
knows.
At school talk shit, you know?
I know, but if you don't talk, I'm just saying it's uncomfortable, and I could see some people not wanting to talk about it with their parents, with their kids, and then the kids end up going down a road that they didn't know was that dangerous because nobody told them.
Right.
When I was in eighth grade, there was a kid that would sit in the back of the class and sniff K.
What's K?
Ketamine.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Damn, that's advanced.
Yeah.
I mean, awesome. I'm fucking advanced loser, but still advanced. Holy shit.
Yeah, I think our town got ketamine pretty early.
Yeah, what's that? Is it because it's like a little town or something?
Maybe. Maybe we had a lot of vets.
I left school super early. I don't remember anybody doing drugs at school because I left school when I was so young. I didn't go to... I think I went to high school for like 2 years, but it wasn't like a... It was like the little... You know what I mean? All I did was I got stabbed in the arm by a dude with a pencil and I fucking set fire to the girls' toilets and I got into some fights with my Asian buddies where I lost. And that's really my... I can't remember anything else happening. I don't remember... You know, I remember being beaten up in the cricket nets. Nobody was smoking weed in the cricket nets. You know what I mean? When I set fire to the girls' toilets accidentally with that stink bomb, like, the only thing I lit was the stink bomb, though. I never saw... Cigarettes. People smoke cigarettes. They brought out... They brought out 15 packs for the kids so you could put them in your... in your shirt pocket and they
your
would,
uniform
and you wouldn't see it. I swear, man, Peter Jackson 15s, and I would buy those and everybody would buy those, but nobody had any drugs. And I'd already when I was in that part of school, I'd already seen everything. I'd already seen people shoot up in front of me, so I knew about all of it, and nope, and which means I would have known for sure if anybody had any of it, because I knew what it was. Nobody fucking had it. Nobody drank. Nobody smoked weed when I was in this. And this school was rough. People headbutted each other and shit. I don't understand why people didn't do drugs.
It's definitely been a thing for a while. Even, like, you know,
dazed and confused kind of shit, like smoking weed in the bathroom or, you know, a recess or something. It's just a thing. And I knew a guy, the guitar player in my band just didn't give a shit about high school. We were rock and roll. He used to take acid before school because it's cheap and it lasts for 8 hours.
Yeah,
that's gnarly.
In my experience, you get more hard drug use in areas that are really, really poor or really, really rich.
What about your kids are in high school? Mm-hmm. Have they said, like, do people still smoke in the bathrooms?
Oh, people, I don't know if the bathroom is the place, but people are doing all kinds of shit, yeah.
In my school, like in my high school when I was in public school, the bathroom never didn't smell like a freshly lit cigarette. It was like a smoking lounge. And you would get in trouble if you got caught, but nobody gave a fuck, and it was really hard to get caught because it always just smelled like someone smoked a fresh ciggy.
I think more people are smoking weed than cigarettes.
Right. We had toleration zones in my... It was exactly the same as Washington Square Park was for weed. Everybody knew it was going on all the time, and once a month the cops would just do a sweep so that you couldn't say they never did anything. Mm-hmm. We had like a dumpster that was out down a long tunnel in my high school, and that's where you smoked. And once every 3 months, the dean of discipline would go out and round everybody up just to say that he did it, but everybody knew it was going on every single day. There was a smoking lounge.
Yeah.
There's a couple of them.
Wow.
Yeah, no drugs, lame. Mm. Drugs. Advanced. My drugs came when I left school.
Yeah, you know, I think the things... But you're talking to kids about things. I think the things that I got in trouble for later on in life, not too much later, were things that, you know, that my parents didn't talk to me about.
Yeah, see? Prove my point.
Yeah.
If you tell them...
Yeah, you should.
Yeah. So you got to tell them all about it and everything. You know, I said to my son told me that my daughter made out with her boyfriend. I was like, you making out with your boyfriend? She's like, no. I'm like, it's not what I heard. So he just makes that up. He just says stuff about me. I'm like, well, you know, if you're making out with someone, that's cool. I'm just... If you do anything more than that, that would be crazy. You know that, right? Like, that's... You know what I mean? You don't know what's going on. You're too young to understand. She's like, I'm not doing any of it. I'm like, okay, I know you're not doing anything. But if you were to do it at this age, it would be... you don't really know what's going on. And he doesn't know what's going on. It's pretty dangerous. And things can happen. You know, you definitely wouldn't want to have sex. She's like, ew, I wouldn't want to have sex. I'm like, I feel like I don't want to talk about this now. You know what I mean? Like, I now feel like I'd be like, okay, cool. Then let's not talk about it. But I'm like, yeah, but if you did... It would be a really bad idea, like, you know, when there's all these STDs and, you know, and pregnancy and crazy stuff can happen. And she's just, like, so horrified that I'm saying it. But I'm like, there's people on TV that have babies that are your age. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Plus, if you talking about that takes the sexy out of sex, that's also a good thing.
Oh, right? I fucking definitely did that, yeah. She was not happy about it at all.
I thought for sure I'd have a problem talking to my kids about various things, but, you know, when you treat it like it's no big deal, you know, it's just part of life, it does make it way easier.
What's up, you fucking bro?
It's not like you... No, but you don't sit them down like, okay, we have to have a special talk. You know, you say, hey, man, what's going on with that chick you're dating?
Let's
rap
about your dick.
Do you guys need condoms? You know?
Yeah.
You guys low on propose.
Has our
low on propose, bro.
You done one of your pink understand?
Oh, my God.
You guys up on the shocker? I said it wrong. That's how much I don't know, man. I never did any of that. I was always a very nice person. I never did... weird things to ladies.
We had,
as they said, do weird things to me.
Like back on the drugs thing, we had Dare come to our school pretty early on. I remember being like a really young kid when Dare first came by.
Oh, I remember the T-shirt, but not in Australia.
They brought a suitcase that when they unlatched it and opened it, it was a plexiglass display case of different drugs.
No way. They did that in my school too.
It was gnarly. And then they're just like top, like introducing each drug and not
real
even
drugs.
Yes. And not even saying like what it did to you, just like, this is angel dust, this is bad. This is cocaine, this is bad. This is pot, that's bad.
Wow.
And when the cop left and we had like recess, the conversation amongst the kids when there was no adults around was like, all right, if drugs didn't do anything bad, which one of those do you think you would try?
Yeah, I know.
I don't think that was their desired result.
Yeah, bringing it to the children in here, it is, here's what it looks like.
I chose angel dust, by the way.
It's just so insane to think that a kid doesn't know. I mean, I got offered crystal meth when I was 11, and he didn't even have to pull it out. I knew what it meant, and I'm not a smart person, and I'm fucking 11. I had the brain of a 7-year-old. I was not an advanced person, and I knew exactly what he meant when he was like, oh, here's some stuff, you know, wake you up, you know, keep you around, and your mom can stay at the party, you know, just don't tell anybody about it. I'm like, don't tell anybody about it.
Yeah.
That's weird.
Yeah.
It seems to me, I'm sorry, go ahead.
That's it, I'm done.
It seems to me that if you're going to talk about drugs, you have to kind of concede the upside. Because if you just say, here's all these drugs, they're hell on earth, they'll ruin your life, they're fucking terrible, well then why the fucking people do them? I mean, you kind of have to say, look, here's why people do
it. Yeah, no, you're telling the truth.
It can be fun, but I'm telling you, ultimately, the juice isn't worth the squeeze.
I would tell stories about, you know, it gives you this sensation, or the euphoria, or this one does this, and this one does that. Then, you know, the possible side effects. Here's a couple of stories of somebody that tried it for the first time, died. Here's a person who did it and they had a stroke in their face. You know, like, show them all the cases of where people have tried it for the first time and died. Like, because that's happened to, like, those hard drugs. So that if I'm a kid and I'm like, oh, okay, so I'll feel like I'm, like, the singer of a band for an hour, but I might die. I'm like, meh. Fucking might die. Right. You gotta be joking me. Right. Like, I was an angry kid, but I definitely knew I wanted to stay alive, so I was never gonna do cocaine.
But curiosity fueled most of my drug experimentation. The first time I did coke, I was 17, and I didn't fully know what it did. Yeah. I snorted this white powder, and I was like, alright, what's gonna happen? Am I gonna hallucinate? Wow. What's this shit like? And I just got, like, energetic, and, you know, 20 minutes went by, and I'm like, what am I supposed to be feeling like?
I think a kid who's 17 who does cocaine is already so fucking energetic that it's like you just sort of did, like, an espresso shot.
Yeah.
Like, to me, that reminds me of the first time I did speed. When I did speed in Australia, I was like, wait, this shit just makes you stay awake. I don't fucking feel anything. I'm just awake. And it was, you didn't feel anything because I feel like I, you know, I mean, when I was 17, I was fucking buzzing anyway. Like, I was like, hey, what's going on? And then you give me meth, and I'm like, I'm just still me. I just, me doesn't sleep. That's the only difference. I didn't do coke until I came to America. When I was older. And I knew it worked.
Aside from doing something that could kill you instantly, there's also the, you know, hey, and then you need to do more, and then you need to do more, and then you're, like, stealing shit from people to get some money to do some so you don't get sick. I mean, there's all kinds of horrible roads you can go down, and I think if you're telling the truth, that's the best talking them out of doing some shit that there is.
It's like a mindset, man, of the person that knows that the next one they do, they can't come back from it, and they have to keep doing it, because that's the thing that kept me alive. I just, that one where it was knocking on the door is so obvious, because you get time to analyze that shit when you're a junkie. You're like, okay, I'll do it tomorrow, and I'm like, man, I'm thinking about that a lot, you know, and I'm like, okay, I did it about a week now where I haven't really done anything but that drug. If this is getting crazy, I won't do it tomorrow, and then feel weird and go, fuck, I'm fucking addicted to this shit. My whole life's over. I always just felt like it was like a gun at my face. If I'm doing it tomorrow, I think I made things, which is the gift and the curse, because I feel like today when things are kind of bad, I make it way worse than it is. So I felt like if I ever did, like, a bunch of heroin in a row, I would be like, you're like the guitarist of the Chili Peppers. Like, you're going to fucking die. Even though I wasn't, you know, I didn't shoot up in my toes or anything.
Right.
But I made it such a huge deal and felt like such a huge loser, and that it was all over if I was to do it ever again from the worst day that I fixed myself. But I feel like, you know, painkillers when I want to do them, or even those fucking dabs, man. I didn't want to talk about it, but I'll talk about it. Fuck it. I did the dab thing. I was getting into it because it's better for your lungs. Idiot. It wasn't better for your lungs. It's got new, it's new, and it's tricky, and it's you have to do stuff, and it's like being a junkie again. You can do stuff. It looks like drugs. You put the thing in the thing, and you get the thing, and you get real high, and you're like, do it, but it's not. You didn't do it. You didn't shoot up. You're not a loser. Maybe you're not, but I am, because I feel like it gets you so high that there's like if you're not doing it all the time, you're like withdrawing from it. Or I felt like I think... I talked to my therapist about it yesterday, because I've been trying to stop all these different things to figure out why I'm sweaty and uncomfortable, and I think it might be that. So I just stopped doing it.
You sweaty now?
Not as much. I mean,
besides Andrew misunderstanding me and deciding that the studio now needs to be as hot as it can be. I am sweaty from that, but that's okay because it's hotter than it can be. But
yeah, you're suffering for his sexual perversions.
He loves it freezing in that room. I don't know what it is, but
is it super warm in here? You've got a hoodie on too, Kevin. Are you warm?
It was last segment. It was warm, but I run cold, so I like it when it's warm. I have a much wider threshold for warmth than I do cold.
Oh, you're a reptile.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think you and I are similar. Because saw when I was freezing the other day, I was like, I can't listen to you anymore. I have to leave because it's too cold in that room. And I looked at you and you had the hoodie on over your head. And I'm like, you cold, dude? You're like, yeah. I'm like, I hate this place. It's too cold. I'll go a little bit cold, but not like cold like you're freezing and I'm freezing. And this one here right now, it's getting to be what it was. It's okay. But before, I was like, man, I'm hot. I walked in hot. I never walk in here hot. I'm always cold. But I think it might be from that shit. I just watch out, everybody, if you're getting into that stuff. I can't believe I'm saying this, but you know, maybe they figured out a way to make it so strong that you might be doing more than you think. Like, I don't know. Maybe I'm older and like I just said, maybe I'm bashing myself, but I already feel better. I stopped yesterday and. I got up this morning, like I went to a steam room yesterday, sweated the rest of it out, then I got up in the morning and trained because I was like convinced myself that that might be the problem, so I was on a mission to not have that as part of it, but I already feel a little bit better and I'm like, I wonder if it's that, like THC can actually make you sweaty, or my therapist seems to think that I'm sweating because my body's getting it you're getting it out of your system because it's too much, your body feels like you're poisoning it. And I'm like, well, that's not cool. And he's like, you know what? The real uncool bit will be when you stop sweating because your body got used to it. And then there'll be another problem that'll come from it. And I'm like, whoa.
Ay, ay, ay.
Right? And I was like, okay, well, I'm gonna go home now and put that stuff in another room and wait for Andrew to do my podcast and make him do a dab. And then I'm going to fucking smash it against the wall because I do not need that shit. But that's me, man. An accidental... junkie mistake for the rest of my life. I gotta watch it. Or, you know, I end up being a hobby dab rat. I don't know what the fuck happened, but I'm like, whoa, look at this thing. I swear, I started watching videos of it too. Why? I'm like, whoa, that guy's got like a dragon bong. What the fuck happened, dude? Calm down.
Yeah. No, the process.
And then I watch, and then the church podcast, they maybe, I'm like, he's like, I don't know how fucking old Joey Diaz is, but he's old and he's not fit. And
I think he's 27.
Okay. Really not. That would make it. I would be like, okay. But yeah, he's ticking and kicking and he eats 3,000 milligram starfish. And then he does stand up all night.
People are just built differently.
But I'm just saying, I watched that shit and I feel like it cursed me. I was like, well, he's fine. I'll eat it. And then when my hip was really sore and I ate 200 milligrams of it instead of taking a painkiller, and it worked. So then I figured maybe I'm okay with it, but I think there's a certain amount you can do where it's not a good idea for some people. I bet you Be Real could do it all day and there's nothing. I feel like certain people, like you just said, but for me,
I mean, I used to you know, be a wake and bake smoker. I could handle it throughout the day. I just hit a certain age where one day it just stopped working for me.
Yeah, I still fall into that sometimes. I see people smoking weed and I'm like, right, it's no big deal. I should be able to do that. And I can't. I mean, I don't make the mistake, but I still occasionally have that impulse of everybody else is doing it. It's fine. Just take a, you know.
Everybody else is doing it. I'll be fine.
I used to be very productive when I would get stoned and I'm now not. So I just work that into my day. When I have everything finished, it's nighttime, all my responsibilities are over, I can relax. I'll smoke, I'll just chill out, be couch locked for a little bit, and then it helps me sleep.
Man, he's making me want to write another love note. It's a sexy man.
Will, is that a love note you have on that piece of paper?
No, it is, we have a few names for the wolf knives. If you would like to go through some of these people.
Go through them.
Yeah.
I'll go through them. Wait, this guy's a bouncer?
Yeah, Sir Sebastian Max Stapler.
How are you? Is he? He's not a sir.
He's a knight.
He's a knight!
And his name is Max Stapler. That's like a really bad Staples superhero commercial or something.
I mean, yeah. Is this a joke?
Maybe like Ruby Glue Stick.
Maybe that's what he wants, isn't it? I don't know. I can only tell you what the name is and what their supposed occupation.
Captain
is.
Headbutt.
All right. Next is Brett Albinet, welder. It says his nickname is Farley.
Well, then he's Farley.
Just Farley.
Well, okay. What the fuck? He says his nickname Farley. What do we call him? Chris Farley? Dead fat guy.
No, no.
Or he's Farley or he's dead fat guy. Take it.
Or he's albino Jamaican.
First time anyone's ever received three names for a wolf knife name. Don't really see that fit. But
dead
anyway.
Albino.
Or Farley.
Okay, we'll stay with Farley. Jonathan Drummond.
He's a barber.
Wait, different strokes.
Yeah.
Right.
What you talking about?
Coffee porn star. No. Sorry. Barbers. I need to get
different penis strokes?
Different penis strokes? What about... that's long.
Well, the show was hyphenated. It took a couple letters out of different.
Different. and finally,
right, that show, the title pointed out how people in the hood say different yes. from rich people,
right?
Yeah,
who pronounce it different.
They really put the oomph on the apostrophe.
There you go, Andrew fixed it.
And finally is David Hook, rental company, Alberta.
Rufio,
Captain Prostitute,
Captain Hand,
Peter Pansexual.
Boom! There you go.
Excellent.
So, New Wolf Knives, Captain Headbutt, Farley, Diffit Pin Strokes, and Peter Pansexual.
Jonathan Drummond, so long.
That's great.
So now what?
This story is ridiculous.
Can't believe how huge we are on YouTube now.
I've had it for a couple of days and I've not...
Jake Paul, here we come, you know?
Throw it out there now. In New Zealand, a man told a woman that he was poisoned and would die unless she had sex with him.
Yeah, no, that works. It never.
The 24-year-old pled guilty...
Wait, she had sex with him?
She must have.
Right, because otherwise there's no charge. You can say that to people on the street.
The police summary of facts states that the man went to the woman's house. I have to assume that
they
knew each other, right. He was red-faced and bent over holding his ribs. He told her he
was bent over and holding his ass cheeks open.
This is awesome.
That was kind of Corey Feldman. He told her he had been beaten up and forced to drink a vial of toxin. He told her he would die unless he didn't sweat it out with it within 48 hours. She suggested he go for a run, but he said it wouldn't work. He had to sweat it out in a particular way. And that there was no antidote because the person who had beat him up was flying overseas. Shortly thereafter, she began receiving emails from an unknown email address appearing to verify the man's story that indeed she needed to have sex with him. The emails instructed her to perform sex acts on the man 4 times and have sexual intercourse 3 times within the 48-hour period to exhaust the toxin from his system. She began to suspect it was the man himself who was sending these emails.
Huh.
Wait, why?
Wait, she blew him 3 times... 2 times and fucked him 3 times?
She said that she only consented because she believed his life was in danger.
I mean, that's the dumbest lady in the world. Isn't there, like, a crime for that?
Yeah, I mean, you would think a court would ask what a reasonable person do in that situation.
Yeah.
A reasonable person's not gonna just...
Right. Oh, then let's have some sex. There's a joke in the movie that... that English guy with the little titties, the real funny guy that wrote The Office.
Ricky Gervais?
Yeah, and he got the movie about God or whatever, the invention of lying.
Oh, yeah.
And then he tells the super hot chick, hey, the world's going to end, we're going to have sex. And she's like ready to go because no one's ever told a lie. So he's like, if you don't fuck me, the world's going to end.
Yeah, I want, like,
being,
that
being
guy...
Being dumb is not a crime, though.
What?
Being dumb is not a crime.
No, I know. I just want a mean.
I wonder how many other ideas that guy went through before he landed on, ah, the poison. That'll get me laid.
I can't believe it worked. He must have, like, scoped for the dumbest person in town.
Exactly. Yeah, here we know that's the biggest stupid head. Yeah.
Just right. Hung out outside of Toilet Paradise.
Oh, man. Maybe he overheard her say, like, the dumbest thing a human can say and was like, oh, I'm going to go over her house and make up a story to have sex with her.
Oh, yeah, she'll fuck the poison out of me.
Maybe the town knows that she's the dumbest person in the world and it's only the beginning of people running death trains on her.
Or somebody had already used that line on her before and been successful. He's like, ooh.
I got to get in on that.
Get more miles out of that poison thing.
All right, well, I just went under 100 on YouTube, so it really is time for me to die. But Logan Paul, I challenge you. I don't know. You know they're boxing? They're boxing people.
Oh, God.
Hopefully they get hurt.
Yeah, my daughter showed me a video of them training. No one's going to get hurt. Don't die.